Welcome to the video. As always, we have something very profound to share here, and we will most certainly share it. We must listen in the mood of repentance, otherwise we're just spinning our wheels. All disciplines, full stop and the wow, are necessary to make genuine, to have genuine consideration take place. So this is all assumed here. We go over and over and over it. Let's get to the heart of it if we can here. Let me see what I can do. There are three trends in the world. Let's just say it this way. There's a way to look at what's taking place in the world. Very simple way to look at it. Very clear, simple way. And that is, let's take the progressive, the materialists, the secular humanists, mostly the liberal party, political party, secular humanist, materialistic, that type of thing. Okay, that's one faction. Then there's what we call the conservative faction, religious conservative faction. Then there's another faction, which I represent, the ascensionists, the going towards enlightenment, those who are choosing enlightenment. So there's these three basic factions in the world actually taking place. Right now. Okay, here's how to characterize them. The conservatives, the religious conservatives, they are trying to be content. They say, we believe there's a way to be content, to find true contentment, having both truth and lies be true. Combination of truth and lies. This is what does it for us. A combination of truth and absurdity is the framework in which we will find true contentment. This is the conservative religious people. This is what they believe. The secular humanist, materialistic, liberal contingents, they say that they are going to find true contentment within just absurdity. Okay. Just absurdity. No truth. Just absurdity will give them, that framework will give them true contentment. Those who are aiming towards enlightenment and the pure lands, reduced intensity zones, they are taking the position that contentment, true contentment, comes only from truth. Just truth. And there you have it. Those are the three basic factions in the world. They're not two factions, there's three. Now, the middle faction, the conservative ones, religious conservatives who believe that they can be, they're only going to be content with a mixture of truth and absurdity. What they do is they split absurdity into two factions, the good absurdity and the bad absurdity. And then they're working to get rid of the bad absurdity. This is what has to happen when we choose this option. And the liberal materialists say, no, all absurdity is good. They say, let's be tolerant of all absurdity. It's all good. Let's not split it into good and bad. And so they feel they're more enlightened. I mean, this is more progressive. The progressives say, all absurdity is wonderful. Whereas the conservatives say, no, there's some absurdity that's really good, and there's others that's really bad, and we need to, you know, get rid of the bad absurdity, and then we'll just have just the good absurdity. And those who the spiritual masters, the enlightened ones, the saviors, the sages, they advocate, their position is that only truth is true and nothing else is true. So they're not struggling with good and bad absurdity at all. No struggle with that at all. So there's three factions now, three factions we have to be aware of. Which one are we choosing? Which one do you choose? You see, this is the question. Now, what we're saying here is that in this world right now, the materialists, the secular humanist materialist liberals, they the situation that they are following is a vast convergence of absurdist trends. They've been setting up all these different absurdist trends, and their goal is to have them converge. And when they converge, this will catalyze a situation that's greater than just the sum of the parts, the sum of the trends. It's greater. It's a catalytic, great convergence. And they feel this will propel them into only absurdity, pure absurdity, which will then give them the contentment that they were all seeking, right? And the conservative religious people, of course, they find that abhorrent. They say, no, there's some bad absurdity. We're sure of that. And we can't have that bad absurdity here at all. So there's a tremendous conflict there between the liberals and conservatives. Tremendous conflict. Now, this convergence of absurdist trends is going to happen very soon. Very soon. I went to the ocean yesterday. There was a big swell, and I was sent there by the Holy Spirit. And I'm studying swells a little bit, and it's interesting. You look at ocean swells, they're talking about like a westerly swell, and then a intense one, and then a low periodic, high periodic, then a southwesterly swell, and there's different directions of the swells. These and different periods of intensity of the swell, like one every 10 seconds, there's a 19 seconds or something. And the fact these swells can converge, and when these swells converge, suddenly boom, you might have a 20-foot westerly swell and an 8-foot southern swell of different periodicness, meaning the time from one swell, ocean swell, to another ocean swell. There's a certain time frame between the sets of waves. Though they're all different, all these swells are different. They can converge. They can converge, and when they converge, pow! Up pops something greater than just adding up this height of this swell and the height of this other one. It changes the equation in some ways. Because sometimes the periodicity of the swells, you get like a double and a triple sort of thing that converge, that in a certain way, and then you get big sets, and the waves are maybe 35 feet or something. They really get these big set waves. Those are convergence of different swells. This is very similar to the what's happening in the world of these trends. These trends have like a periodicity to them, like waves, like a big swell in the ocean. And also you have tides. Tides influence it also. So you have a lot of factors taking place ideologically in the world. The ones who are going for pure absurdity want to knock out the ones who are going for a mixture of truth and absurdity. They're trying to get rid of them. And vice versa. For a long time, the conservatives have held the upper hand here, of the truth and absurdity ones. That faction has held the upper hand in this world. Now that has changed, and those who want just pure absurdity, complete absurdity, no truth at all, they are now have the upper hand. And they're very sneaky, very tricky. They have all these various trends and from different directions. But their plan is to have these trends converge. And this will catalyze what they call a new world order. This is their dream. This is what they feel. This is the framework in which they will feel. They believe they can find true contentment, is what they call the new world order. Now, of course, the religious conservatives are abhorrent about this. They say it's abhorrent. We know that some absurdity is bad absurdity. You know, our teachers have told us this. You know, our saviors have told us this, that there's some, this is how they see it. And so they say this, that's abhorrent, absolutely abhorrent to us. But it's also true that you do not find true contentment within a mixture of truth and absurdity. And so these conservatives, that they're frustrated by this. And so they're looking for, you know, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? What do we do? We need a little more time, more time. But they're running out of time. So they feel great danger of being pulled into this totally absurdist culture that's coming here. But some of them are slipping down into that, slipping down into that. They say, "Ah, let's give this a try." That, you know, half truth, some truth and some lie and some absurdity just didn't work for us. So I guess we got no choice but to try. You know, we kind of have to go along with this absurdist culture. This is something that is happening also. So you have some of the conservatives going over to the complete absurdist side. You also see some of them trying to get with the just truth, only truth, only truth. But that's it's difficult. It's difficult for them because they're used to ruling the roost here, and when they go into this, only truth is true and nothing else is true, they feel like they're like beginners at this, you know, and they don't like that. That's understandable. Because and they find out that there are some who've already, you know, accepted this position, and are dwelling in true contentment, and this, you know, it bothers them because they say, "Wow, I'm used to having a lot of power and authority, and I don't right now. I realize that I don't have that yet. I mean, there are others way above me that, you know, who are much more advanced than this. They've done it already, and I'm still haven't done it at all." So this really is a bitter pill to swallow. It really is, which is why we need humility on the path, humbleness on the path. There are those who have tried to combine truth and lies, try to live in a context of truth and absurdity, and try to be content with that, who've really, really tried so much, who feel they're authorities on this, you know, they're really authorities about, "I know so much about how to do this, I work so much at this, and so you know, I feel like I should be listened to, even though I'm doesn't work. I'm not content. I feel as that." So there is this troubling bridge to cross. It's very humble to come across those who have accepted only truth as true. So there is this path, a bridge that we must cross. There's a bridge we must cross. Most of us must cross. But it's a better bridge to cross than the bridge towards total absurdity. That is for sure. Now, those who are going for total absurdity, they're not really reachable right at this point, because they see their nirvana is approaching, their heaven is approaching, total absurdity. They feel there's a way to reach this, so they're not interested in truth. The conservatives, those who are both truth and absurdity, they are angry, they're frustrated, but some of them perhaps can be reached. But there's this bridge that must be crossed, and it requires humility. Which is difficult, but it has to be done. Because, for instance, the Jesus that they have been believing in, they put an absurdist, they put a false context onto Jesus' teachings of, well, the truth is true. Thank you, Jesus, that you brought us the truth. But they say, but some absurdity is also true. So we've got to combine the two. This is the Chalcedonian creed of Jesus as both divine and human. They say both truth, true and absurd. And so they've been following that false teaching, really. Well, let's put it this way. Trying to find true contentment within that context, it doesn't work. It won't be found. So it's not what we really want. It doesn't really work, let's put it this way. They've been following that. So then you find out that, hey, when you take that position of truth and absurdity both being true, you feel you need this all-powerful savior figure to make it happen for you, and that nothing else can interfere. You have to focus in because it becomes an idol. You make an idol out of the teacher of truth. And when you make it, then the idol demands total obedience, and there are no other idols. You feel that this is the trouble, that you're being tempted towards in some other directions. Why the temptation? Because we're not finding true contentment. And so we're tempted towards what? True contentment. We're tempted towards truth. And so when we have made an idol out of a teacher of truth and believing they can help us get rid of the bad absurdity and keep the good absurdity, you get locked into this very rigid framework where only your teacher is teaching is the right teacher, and no one else can teach you, that they're superior to all their teachers because they can teach you, we believe, they can teach us how to get rid of the bad absurdity and keep the good absurdity and make both truth and absurdity true. So we think that they're superior to all their teachers because the other teachers, they're just saying, well, just truth is true. But you think that you're finding a higher, we think we're finding a higher teaching. Only this one teacher can do it. Okay. This is what we get locked into. So when we find out that there are other teachers that are enlightened, we say, no, that can't be, that can't be, that can't be. So we have trouble with ecumenicalism. But as you go along this bridge of humility, eventually you start realizing, wow, there are many teachers of truth, that only truth is true, nothing else is true. Eventually, and it's always a surprise when you come across another teacher that's enlightened. You say, "Wow, I didn't know that. I didn't know that." What? So, of course, if you're trying to make both truth and absurdity true, you're trying to be greater than God. And so you feel you need some super teacher that's greater than all other teachers, and none of them, other ones are not even true at all, actually. And so what Jesus says, you make an idol out of him. He says that we've made some very, very nasty idols out of him, very bitter idols, and he's here to help us liberate. Jesus is here to liberate us from the idol Jesus, okay? He's here to help liberate us from the idol Jesus that we have imagined in order to try and empower contentment through both truth and lies and absurdity being true by getting rid of the bad absurdity and keeping the good absurdity. And what Jesus tells us is that all absurdity is equally absurd. There's no good or bad absurdity. There's no bifurcation into good and bad absurdity. We've tried to disassociate our mind to try, over here's the bad absurdity, over here's the good absurdity. Okay, that doesn't work. So Jesus is helping us free us from the idolization of Jesus. So when Jesus came back to this world, which he did in the spring of 215, he said, I'm here back to relate with you as a friend. Okay, this is very, very important. That was his transmission. That was his, one of his empowerments that he's already given out. We're waiting for the next one. Or we're working so that we can be ready for the next one. Now, I can tell you, as someone who's been working through all this, it does come as a shock when you realize there are other ones that are enlightened as well. There are other great teachers. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to abandon Jesus or abandon whoever your teachers are. No. Let me say this. Let's say I was in a vast ocean of this terrible storm, and I was sinking, and the waves were, and I was just desperate. I said, and let's say there was a boat with all the great teachers there are, and they were reaching their hands down to me. A lifeboat says, "Here, take my hand. I'll pull you out of this terrible, treacherous ocean." Whose hand would I grab? Whose hand would I grab? Whose arm? I reach, that arm is reaching down. I grab a hold of that arm to pull me out of the ocean. Who? If for me, it's a no-brainer. It'd be Jesus, for sure. Absolutely, it would. And I wouldn't even think about it. I was just like that, because Jesus is, you know, just tremendously great teacher. There's no question about it. And for me, he's given the widest context. He's answered my questions. Okay, so I'd grab a hold of Jesus. Absolutely. But that doesn't mean that there aren't other teachers who are perfectly capable of pulling me out of the ocean also. It's just that I know, I'm absolutely sure that Jesus can get the job done. There's no question about it. And I have the most assurance, I would say, because of the very wide context that he has given, which I don't hear from the other teachers so much, because their way of working is slightly different. They're more very focused on practice, less on theory. Whereas for me, I like to see the theory also. This I find that helpful. Anyway, I'd grab a hold of Jesus. So I don't abandon Jesus. Nobody has to abandon Jesus. I've gone through this path. I'm very aware. I've received empowerments from many teachers now. Received one from Jam Yang, Kienzi, what is it? Choko Lodri or something like that. This is Jam Yang Kienzi. I didn't even know that about him. He was here, he died in 1959. He was born in 1893. Many great teachers are born like in the 1890s, it seems like. It's very interesting. Anyway, he was born in 1893, passed away in 1959. So I was alive when he was still alive. But I didn't even know about him. But I would say he's a great teacher. The impression I get is this is someone that's actually enlightened. There's no, you know, this is a no doubt about it, powerfully enlightened one. And his spiritual consort, which showed up, the great Dakini, Chandro Sering, something, Chodron, something like that. She showed up recently, a couple of days ago, to give me an empowerment. And she was his spiritual consort for a long time. Now, so in Tibetan Buddhism, a spiritual consort of a great master like this is a very, very high spiritual being indeed. So getting the empowerment from her is an empowerment by extension of Jam Yang Kienzi Chokyo Loki, something like that. I'm sorry if I don't. I'll get it eventually. They have these very many, many, and there's different names for them too. They have multiple names. Tibetans have multiple names for these teachers. But I think people know the great Rime Master, who super ecumenical master, which I am in this lineage of super ecumenicalism. This is where I feel comfortable. And he was a super ecumenical. He brought all traditions of Tibetan Buddhism together and reconciled them within himself. He says, look, we're all, the many pass up the mountain, but the view from the mountain is the same, okay, for all of us. It's the same. And he was supposedly an emanation of Vimalamitra, who brought Buddhism to Tibet, one of the key teachers who brought Buddhism to Tibet, along with Padmasambhava. Let's just say, you know, the names I'd struggle sometimes. I can't remember. That's okay. What's in the name? We understand the essence of what we're talking about. So he is this very powerful transmission. And Longchenpa was incarnation of Vimalamitra, as well as transmissions from some other sources to put everything together too. So Longchenpa was a super ecumenical teacher also, who brought all these different trends together and says, look, this is, we're all going to the same mountaintop here. Okay, so Jamyang Gyentse also was so is in this lineage that Longchenpa is all part of. Longchenpa is supposedly the pinnacle of this lineage, actually, pinnacle of it. So I'm part of that lineage too. I'm part of this ecumenical ism. You see, so you can't really pin me down and say I'm this or this or this. No, for me, it's ecumenicalism, pure ecumenicalism. The view from the mountaintop is the same. So why are we fighting over anything really so much, you know? Why are we wasting time in that? The goal, get to the mountaintop. And there's one practice, really, and that is intense practice every day. That's the one practice. That's the one. And for me, there's one technique, which is full stop in the wow. One ideology is this. Well, I represent this path of just truth. Only truth is true. Nothing else is true. Jesus is absolutely part of all this. Central to it, maybe you might. Co-centric, we might say, to be ecumenical, is totally co-centric with all of this. Perfectly, immaculately co-centric. Only truth is true, nothing else is true. So as you rise up in this ecumenicalism, you come across these great spiritual teachers. This is what has happened. Anamayama also, perfectly ecumenical, this great perfectly ecumenical teacher. Raman Maharshi as well. Okay, so you get this ecumenicalism. Where you have trouble is when in this faction that is trying to make both truth and absurdity live in that context and get rid of the bad absurdity, this is where you have the conflict. And you see the conflict in the world now between various factions of this faction of trying to live with both truth and absurdity and get rid of the bad absurdity. Well, because it doesn't work, there are different ideas constantly arising of what constitutes the bad absurdity. So you see various factions of this, and then within these factions, let's say, for instance, Christianity had Catholicism and Reformation, which is Protestantism became, and there was factionalism in Catholicism all along. You know, and then what the winning party would anathematize the losing party and excommunicate them. Say, this is happens all along. It happens in other traditions too right now in the world. There's infighting among various factions. The reason this takes place is because they can't agree about what constitutes the bad absurdity. This is the terrible cross that this one of the three factions has, this perspective of, again, there's three, there's just truth is true and nothing else is true. Then there's this other perspective, other faction, which says that truth is true and also some absurdity is true. But there's absurdity, there's good absurdity, which is also true, and there's bad absurdity, which isn't true. And we can be content within that. And then there's the third faction, which says only absurdity is true. So that third faction, only absurdity is true, wants to have this global bureaucratic dictatorship, New World Order, which just everyone is under this extreme technological control, monitored 24/7, to make sure that no truth is present. And to make sure that there's no more factionalism about good absurdity and bad absurdity, they say that all absurdity is good. What is that? That keeps. They want to say all absurdity is great, And so they want to monitor everything, and this is what they're going for. So they suffer under this obsessive compulsive awful mental struggles in trying to monitor everything and control everything. Police state. Now you might have peace in the police state, no factionalism, because they take, you know, drastic measures to iron that all out, to crush everything, crush all dissent, to brainwash, massive efforts to brainwash, to use compounds, medicinal compounds, all sorts of techniques. They have all sorts of more advanced or different types of techniques now, technologies, nanotechnology, you know, just total control, genetic engineering, whatever they have to do to wipe out both the notion of truth and the idea that some absurdity is good and some is bad. They just want pure absurdity, no bifurcations. They think they get rid of the split in the mind this way. Okay, so that's the curse that they live under, is a prison planet, to say the least, is what their goal is. The other is what we've been living through for the last, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6,000 years, however long, is this: some absurdity is good, some is bad, let's get rid of the bad absurdity. So you have, it's sort of, you have wars, you have conflict, you have disagreements, but you also have reconciliations taking place. You say, okay, you have ecumenicalism sort of taking place, reformations, revivals take place. So it's up and down. It's ragged. It's up and down. It's ragged. And of course, we're tired of this raggedness, you know, which is why some of us are being tempted by this just pure absurdity movement. Thinking, God, at least there won't be this raggedness, you know, we'll all just be imprisoned. And you're looking, we're all in this, you know, cell blocks, concrete cell blocks, and say, okay, good, at least there's no factionalism, you know. It's being suppressed. And yet it keeps wanting to emerge against it. No, I think I see some bad absurdity, you know. So even more drastic controls are brought into place, and just, you know, just super brainwashing. Super, from cradle to grave, everyone is just super brainwashed and roboticized. You know, now the robotic therapy. We have therapy with robots, actually. They will assign a robot companion to us to smooth us out, you know, keep us in line. Truly, we will have robot companions. This faction will. Smartphone is, you know, a step in that direction, to say the least. Those of you smartphones are getting ready for robotic companionship, and having all sorts of implants. Those are putting all sorts of implants in their body. They're getting ready to have all sorts of these technological implants that monitor them constantly, to try to keep their brain. You know, they'll shock their brain wave monitoring. If it starts going over towards factionalism, you know, shock the brain, you know, like that, and all sorts of stuff. You know, it'll put chemicals, we'll have stuff that patches that will secrete chemicals into our bloodstream. When our brainwaves start, our attitude starts going a certain way, that'll immediately put us back into, you know, zombie land. But this is just the many, 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 many things is what this absurdist culture has in store for us, for those who choose that. So the lifeline, Jesus threw out a lifeline with A Course in Miracles. He really did. He said, truth is true, only nothing else is true. Only truth is true, nothing else is true. He brought the true gospel again. He reintroduced the true gospel. Says, look, I'm putting my hand down into this ocean. Grab a hold of my hand. I'll pull you out of this ocean of misery here. And you can go to just truth is true, nothing else is true. Now, when you do that, you realize, hey, others have been going in that direction too, other traditions. And some have reached that, have accepted it, this. Which is kind of like surprising. What? Huh? Shocking. That's kind of shocking, actually. Yeah, I look at Jamyang Yinsi, I check shocking, like, wow. Very surprising. Even the, even the Hindus or other traditions, like that, even they are not so aware of that. Everyone's very much into their own tradition. They're not very much aware of other traditions. I have to say the Tibetans are not very aware of the Christian tradition either. They really are not, which is kind of shocking. Someday they're gonna meet Jesus Christ, and that'll be interesting for them. That is for sure. They may not know about like Anandamayima. Apparently they don't, which is kind of shocking. They may not know Ramana Maharshi. They feel their own teachers are good enough, which that is certainly true in a certain sense, and yet they're bedeviled by factionalism. Don't think that. That's why the Rime movement is such great efforts have been taken to harmon, to stop the factionalism infighting. But factionalism is inherently endemic to the second perspective of trying to find true contentment in truth and absurdity and getting rid of the bad absurdity. Factionalism is endemic to this. So a Rime movement is only a bridge. It's nothing that can be permanently established. Okay, it is not a, it cannot. Because the absurdists say, okay, if we can only get this ecumenicalism within the context of truth and good absurdity both being valid, then this will get rid of the bad absurdity and we'll be happy. No, this will never work. This will never work. Ecumenicalism is a bridge. It's a bridge, but the bridge leads to only truth is true and nothing else is true. This is where the bridge leads. So in crossing this bridge, it's a very compelling experience, to say the least. You have to manage your success and do it in every step you take. It's like, wow, you come across more and more and more truth. And you must manage your success. You must have these tools. So this is what I'm working on and sharing with everyone. As I cross the bridge, do my crossing of the bridge, I'm broadcasting back to others who are also crossing it. I'm saying, this is what I'm experiencing up here, I'm trying to reassure all of you bridge crossers that keep going, but manage your success. Now, I had this great breakthrough last night. And I've had to manage the success of that. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. So, I'm doing this, and it's very helpful to say, use this form of practice. I can do whatever the breakthrough says. I can see it this way. I will see it this way. I am already seeing it this way. So instead of struggling, I'm trying to remember, what was that breakthrough? How am I going to teach others? How can I share this? What? Put a stop to that. Put a stop to that. That's called full stop in the wow. Just allow the wow to be there and then practice. Say, I can see it this way. I will see it this way. I am already seeing it this way. So in other words, this puts you in the seat of confidence. Meaning, you are going to cross that bridge all the way. And when you do, then you will see it this way. No question about it. It won't be difficult at all. There'll be no struggle at all, actually. So put yourself in the seat of confidence, not in the seat of, I'm coming from, partial absurdity, partial truth. How do I put it in that context? Don't try to do that. This is what pulled, then we turn around, we start looking back. Don't look back. This is something I believe that is something important in many traditions. They say, don't look back. I believe Longchenpa said that, certainly in Judeo-Christianity. Gee, this is, don't look back. Don't look back. You'll be turned into stone, so to speak. So when you get this breakthrough of seeing it from the perspective of just truth is true, which is what I experienced last night. I had this breakthrough. You could say it's a great breakthrough. And I saw it all from the perspective of truth. I had that perspective. I saw it. I said, okay, wow. Glimpsed it. So, okay, so I can see it this way. I will see it this way. I am already seeing it this way. Okay, this is very important practice. You must have these certain practices to manage your success, because you will get these glimpses as you go along, as you're shifting perspective from trying to be content, find true contentment in both truth and absurdity. As you're shifting out, going across this bridge towards finding true contentment in that just truth is true, nothing else is true, you will get these glimpses. You have to manage your success. Say, wow, I'm getting there. This is great. So you must remain humble. Full stop on the wow. Receiving an empowerment, for instance, from Jamyang Yenzi. This is very, very profound. This is a great, great teacher in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. They say the top teacher of the 20th century in Tibetan Buddhism. And Bet Beads, he's in that echelon of top teachers of the century as you go back. You know, this is a very high echelon to be in. And so receiving a transmission from him and making his acquaintance here, this is very, very significant. Very significant. Very humbling, actually. I shed some tears over it. Very humbling. When someone reaches out ecumenically to you, it's very humbling. He showed his ecumenical spirit by reaching out to someone who's not in the mainstream of, you know, Tibetan Buddhism. I'm not a Tibetan Buddhist mainstream, you know. I'm Jesus, Judeo-Christianity, A Course in Miracles. That's my mainstream. But for him to reach out that way and treat me as if I was part of his tradition, well, very humbling. Very humbling. Because what is his tradition really? It's ecumenicalism. Same with Longchenpa. Extremely ecumenical. So what they're saying is, hey, look, there is a echelon above even the traditions, okay, and we're welcoming you into that club. So the ecumenalists, they know they're the birds of a feather flock together, and they know which birds are flying in that way. And so they say, hey, hi, you know, I'm part of this ecumenicalism too. Lovely to make your acquaintance, you know. I'm very pleased. So, from this perspective, we see it in there, that there's three different perspectives that spirit is entertaining, you see. Trying an adventure to try and see. You know, it's an adventure. So, I don't look at it in terms of different religions, different traditions. I see it as these three different perspectives that we're working. And in this middle, you might say the middle perspective, of trying to combine truth and absurdity, you have these different traditions to work your way out of that, because the basic premise is that there's good and bad absurdity. So what we start with is, okay, what teaching can help me purify myself, get rid of the bad absurdity, you see? And so there's, and since that really doesn't work, it inherently becomes factional. There's an inherent factionalism within it. So in order to reach down into this perspective, inherently it becomes factionalized, you see? Inherently so. So we have to recognize this and stop the factionalism. We have to stop fighting, and there has to be more and more ecumenicalism in terms of not trying to combine the traditions. No, I'm not trying to combine the traditions. It's that there's a higher echelon of pure ecumenicalism, actually, where it doesn't even, there's no attempt to purify anything. And it, and from that standpoint, this transcends all traditions entirely, actually. And yet, to teach, you have to appear within some tradition, basically. Most, for the most part, I don't really appear in any tradition so much. So this is why not many can say, what was he talking about? What tradition are you in? Because it's time for me to drop that, you know. Maybe in some future life I'll appear in some tradition or something. But the great teachers are often, they appear in traditions, but they themselves transcend all traditions. So they'll speak to those who are engaged in a tradition using the language and the practice and everything. But what they're really doing is leading them out of that, out of all practice altogether, is the truth. And this is difficult for us because we're still attached to a tradition which we don't quite see where it sprang from. So we think that, you know, some practice identifies us with this tradition. And no practice, we feel, oh my gosh, you know, I don't have a tradition. Yes, we do. We'd have this ecumenical tradition. So maybe in the ocean, I would reach up both arms and I'd say, hey, everybody grab hold. That's a safe, you know, that's a safer pull. Co-centric. They're all co-centric in my book. Because the perspective that I glimpsed is you cannot even speak of a tradition or teachers or anything. It is, I don't want to try too hard to define it, you know, because that gets in the way of the wow if we start trying to do that. A little chilly today. Not like yesterday, yeah. They said it'd be cloudy today, and well, they were right about that. So if when I'm comfortable talking about it, I will. I have to be careful not to struggle, though, with trying to define or, you know, to, because who am I speaking to is the question. Who am I speaking to? Who am I speaking with? Who am I speaking with? Who am I sharing with? Who am I sharing with? What am I sharing with? So what experience I had was a extraordinarily ecumenical. It was a pinnacle of ecumenicalness, so to speak. So now I'm needing to go back and smooth it out and see, you know, how did I get here? Sort of looking back on my path in some way, or seeing how can you get here? I want to be able to make sure that you can get here as well. And so I'm looking to see, oh, okay, I'm putting it in context, and this is part of what is helpful. Yogananda was an ecumenical teacher. In some ways, he was moving in that direction. The Ananda Fellowship, SRI, and the various things they do, they have, you know, the Jesus, Krishna, and they have very various, you know, they try to make it ecumenical to a certain extent. But it still is Hindu-centric. But it was an ecumenical trend. It was an ecumenical trend. So I got some help with that when I was young. I read Autobiography of a Yogi by Paramahansa Yogananda, and he introduced all these, various things that he combined, kind of Christianity and Hinduism. It's a sort of a combination, and he sort of widened, broadened the spectrum. He broadened the, helped broaden, widen the spectrum, really. So he helped bridge. He was part of the helping bridge. So for many, that's a good place to start. Many have started that way. And then I've gone on to that, receive many, many empowerments along the way. When you see like Jamyang Yentsi, Loki Chodro, something like that, or Chodro Loki, I'm not sure which way. But when you see that, you just want to sit. You just want to sit with that. Wow. There's no need to ask any questions. That's pure ecumenicalism right there. Pure ecumenicalism. There's no need for stories. There's no need for traditions. There's no need for any of that. Just sit and be quiet. This is the omni-perfection of truth, the universal of universe of truth, present. Now, Tibetan Buddhism enabled that presence to be here, so kudos to that. Just as Hinduism enabled, like Anandamayi Maharshi to be there, kudos to them. And Judaism enabled Jesus to be there. Kudos to Judaism. And now Christianity is allowing Jesus to come back, so kudos to Christianity. And also kudos to other traditions too. For all the ecumenicalism that they've been part of. Actually, it's those who, well, yeah, no, I said it right. Those who made a lot of progress in Christianity were able to accept A Course in Miracles and make a lot of progress with that, which has enabled Jesus to return, actually. That's the vehicle of his return. So it's a collective effort throughout thousands of years of Christianity that has enabled Jesus to return. So we've done a great job. That this tradition, I say we, but that this great tradition has done a great job, as have others. So it's just those who are truly ecumenical. We're not saying coexist. That's not, no. You see these bumper stickers, coexist. No. That's the second perspective of trying to get rid of bad absurdity and have only good absurdity and have both absurdity and truth coexist. That is not ecumenicalism at all. Ecumenicalism is the view from the top in which there isn't anything to coexist. There's no such situation at all. there's only the omni-perfection that is everywhere. The universe, truth, loves truth. Perfection loves perfection. That's it. There's only perfection loving perfection. And this is omnipresent. So the love of perfection for perfection is omnipresent. This is what we call the love. And these great teachers are simply in that. This is the presence. There's nowhere else to be, they realize. There's only that. It is omnipresent. There's no out of that. The suchness, they call it out. There's only the suchness of perfection, loving perfection. Universal perfection, loving universal perfection. That's it. This is truth. There's not a trace of factionalism at all, or bifurcation or anything like that. So the perspective of trying to be content with absurdity, they're telling the second perspective of trying to make both truth and absurdity abide with both truth and absurdity and get rid of bad absurdity. They're working on them, saying, look, the problem is you believe in truth. Got to get rid of truth. So the real goal is to get rid of truth altogether. Trying to destroy all bridges. You know, there's no bridges whatsoever. And they say, you see, you're happy. The struggle, the strain of crossing that bridge, you don't have to worry about that anymore. There are no bridges. You see, because the crossing this bridge from factionalism to no factionalism at all is a struggle. It's difficult because you have continuity fear. So it's a challenge. It's a challenge. So what the absurdists say, the absurdist faction say, let's just pure absurdity, that's it. They say, look, we'll remove this challenge from you, and that'll make you content. You won't have to take on this challenge, this difficult challenge. You won't have to do that. And so this is a temptation. This is how they tempt. This is how they tempt. So this perspective, the second perspective of trying to be content with both truth and absurdity. This is thinning out. It's thinning out here. It's called sitting on the fence. You can't really sit on the fence. You won't be able to sit on the fence in this world anymore coming up very soon. You won't be able to sit on the fence. You'll either get pulled into total absurdity, or you'll decide this taking this bridge, crossing this bridge, this is what I am going to do, and this is my commitment now. And then you will go to a reduced intensity zone. Well, you work on that. This is what's called the rapture in Christianity, is those who, the fence sitting is over with in this world. It's over with. Politically in the United States, it's being represented in this way. What's happening is You have Bernie Sanders, which is that let's just go all complete absurdity, let's get rid of all bridges. You have Hillary Clinton who's saying, let's build a bridge into absurdity. Okay. Let's build a bridge into we can all transfer into absurdity. Or Bernie says, no, let's just do it right now. We're all observers. Hillary says, I can build a bridge into absurdity. And Trump says, let's just stay in this middle perspective, this second perspective of let's get rid of the bad absurdity and keep truth and the good absurdity. That's what Trump is about. Course, we don't, a true ecumenical candidate, we don't have one. I say, maybe I am that one. I can be that. I'm a non-candidate for president, the perfect non-candidate. No candidacy. Yeah, you can look at it that way. I'm a presidential. You can choose me as your president, but I'm not running any campaign, and I don't have any candidacy. It's pure ecumenicalism that we will go to. Just truth is true. Nothing else is true. So yeah, I'm the fourth candidate for president, but I'm a non-candidate candidate, where we keep the bridges. All bridges are open. Okay, whatever bridge you are. So all traditions, the bridges at which they are, they're all traditions are just bridges. All traditions, get on that bridge and go towards truth, and you will be welcome there, no matter what your tradition is. So if you want to think in the context of that, I'll be the fourth candidate for president here, representing this other option. You know, this other option. Get on the bridge. That's a vote for me, is to get on that bridge, okay, and choose to go to a reduced intensity zone. That's how you vote. You vote with your feet. You vote with your spiritual orientation is how you vote for me for president. So Hillary said, I'll build a bridge into absurdity, don't worry. Bernie says, what the heck with bridges? I'm already there. Let's do it now. Hillary says, not quite yet. You need to help build your bridge to that. I'll get you there. Bernie says, no, we don't need to get there. We're already there. Let's just, crush everything else. Let's just appropriate all property, all wealth. Let's just grab a hold of everything right now. And Hillary says, not so fast. I don't want my money grabbed a hold of you. Let's she's a womanly way. Like, I've got the way to ease into it. I can ease into that. Come on. And Trump says, no. Let the wealthy keep their wealth. It's good for the economy. We can keep some truth. Let's have some truth in this world, and let's get rid of the bad absurdity. I'll help you get rid of the bad absurdity. That's his standpoint, viewpoint. Brisk, businesslike, pragmatic, that kind of thing. And then here is his fourth viewpoint. Clarity or candidate, non-candidacy for president is get on the bridge to this the perspective that only truth is true and nothing else is true. Get on that bridge from whatever tradition. Whatever it is, doesn't matter. Even if you're an atheist, get on the bridge towards only truth is true and nothing else is true. Whatever your background, get on that bridge and start walking across that bridge. Get on that bridge and let's walk across that bridge. Because we can do that. I understand how to do it. We can do that. You can do that. You absolutely can. You just have to full stop on the wow. you're going to this pure ecumenical viewpoint, and I've glimpsed it. It is there, no doubt about it. When you decide that's what you want, that's what you will experience. Perfection, loving perfection, with no other love. So crisis is coming. Convergence of trends is coming. What will happen along those lines? Well, we want to be very empowered before that happens. So I'm working to bring this empowerment. To help bring it about, this ecumenical empowerment. It's pure ecumenicalism. Remember, we're not talking about coexistence. That is the false. That is the second perspective of getting rid of bad absurdity. Okay, we're not about that at all. Not at all. We're about transcending all traditions ultimately. Okay? You don't need them anymore. Completely free. The vision at the top. Phew, you're entirely free of all of that. As if it never was. Free of all factionalism. Free of all bridges. Entirely free of all bridges. You're in the bridge-free land now. You dwell in the bridge-free Omniverse. The endless, eternal Omniverse. Absolutely no bridges anywhere. No need for any bridges whatsoever. You are there. Always there. In perfection, loving perfection. Don't try to conceptualize it too much. It came about. I was working with Longchenpa's words, putting some of his words onto a graphic, beautiful graphics from Nicholas Roark, that I made these composites of Nicholas Roark's paintings into a new painting, composite painting, putting some of Longchenpa Jesus, all ecumenical one, putting some of his teachings there, and working with this, and then watching a video of the life of Jamyang Gyentse, the combination of all this and my aspirations and prayers and the day and everything, I just had this just glimpse, just like that, just at the very end. I saw it. It was that quick. It was just a glimpse. I said, okay, great. This is what they're all pointing to. But this coexist sort of thing is most definitely, that is not it. And many, many, many are getting deceived by this. And leaving them vulnerable to this, the third perspective of just all absurdity, pure absurdity. As if somehow... that coexist movement is really the New World Order movement co-opting these bridges and saying, look, we can get rid of all bridges by just making total absurdity. That's how we can do it. That's what it is. This is why I call this the yoga girl trend, which is such a dangerous trend. Such a dangerous trend. It's setting us all up. Those in this second perspective of let's get rid of the bad absurdity and just keep the good, what they're saying is, oh no, we don't even need to, we can all get along, we can all get along. What they're really saying is all absurdity is good. When they say coexist, this is really a sneaky way of saying all absurdity is good. We can get rid of the factionalism, by just saying all absurdity is good. There's not good absurdity and bad absurdity. All absurdity is good. This is what the yoga girls are up to. When I call yoga girls, I mean, you know, I think it's a very evocative term. It's the girl that goes to yoga and she's very flexible and limber, comes limber and flexible and takes on this spiritual patina superficially and say, I'm very spiritual. Now I understand spiritual truth because I can get in this asana, you know, it's like that. And coexist, we could coexist, let's just do this asana, look how flexible I am. It's a superficial flexibility they're talking about. This is what is leading the world, deceiving the world, one of the very nasty trends is leading us into saying all absurdity is good. Why? We don't need this factionism of good and bad absurdity. Well, why are you doing that? That's stupid. All absurdity is good. This is where it's going. This is not what I'm about. Where I'm about is all truth is true and nothing else is true. All truth is true, nothing else is true. And no absurdity is true. All absurdity is equally absurd, actually. All absurdity is equally absurd. So these very deceptive trends have set us up to be vulnerable to other deceptive trends. You know, we're being herded into this corral, as it were. We're being herded into this absurdist New World Order prison. And prison is a very mild term to use for it, actually. It's a systematic, very thorough systematic effort for us to abide in total absurdity and insist that all absurdity is equally true or equally wonderful, equally good. Let's say not true, equally good. All absurdity is equally good, they're saying. It's trying to shape our beliefs, a belief system that accepts this. This is why it's so malefic, so terrible. It is a shaping of a belief system, a shape, and what happens is all these various trends are going to coalesce into a belief system, and then the yoga girls are going to slam the door saying, look, coexist, this is coexistence, this is true ecumenicalism, no, it's not, because it's taking the idea of ecumenicalism as an end in itself, and losing sight of what it's really pointing to. Being tolerant of other of all traditions is not an end in itself at all. It helps us each one get across that bridge until you get to the top of the mountain, and then you see the true perspective from there, where all bridges, there are no bridges at all from that perspective. There's no need for any bridges from that perspective at all. So the yoga girls are particularly dangerous, very dangerous, because they have the good patina attached to them, that you can trust them, that they understand spirituality. So what a lot of these yoga girls have attached themselves to various traditions to learn enough about them so they can talk the talk and wear the clothing and appear to be very spiritual. And then they'll say, well, we're into coexistence, we're very ecumenical. And they're not. They're leading us into the New World Order of let all factions of absurdity coexist. It's all absurdity is good. This is what they really are about. And you can tell the difference between a true spiritual, let's say, a true spiritual person and a yoga girl like Chandra Sering, children, the consort, spiritual consort of Jiayang Yanzi, look at her, you see that. That is true ecumenicalism there. You can feel that. You can see it. Compare that, to contrast that with the yoga girl coexisting. And you say, wow. These are not birds of a feather at all. And they say, what's going on? I'm confused. Well, I'm not confused. I never have been. It's just difficult to deliver this message because they keep, you know, acquiring more and more patina. They go to all these teachers, and of course the teachers are, I think they kind of, they realize that what's going on, but I don't know, they do, you know, they flock to these, all these teachers, flocks and flocks and flocks of these yoga girls, because they want to say, look, I'm ecumenical, I'm aware of this tradition, I'm aware of this tradition, and then they say, okay, now we can, all these traditions can just coexist, but the goal again, is that all absurdity is equally good. It's all good. And we're in charge of this all goodness of absurdity. That's the role that they see themselves as. They're going to be in charge. Well, they have a big surprise in store for them. There's others who believe that they're going to be in charge. Like the reptilians, okay? They believe they're going to be in charge. They're just using the yoga girls. And the yoga girls think that they're going to outfox the reptilians, which females generally believe that they can outfox whatever they want to outfox. They can find a way to do it. And so they're vulnerable. They don't see danger very clearly. This is one of their great failings. This is the failing of Eve, is she didn't recognize the danger the snake represented. She says, I can outfox the snake. Oh, I see the danger, but I can outfox the snake, no problem. Whereas Adam would say, no, this is too much trouble. I'm not going to entertain this. The yoga girls are saying, look, we can find a way to make all absurdity equally good. We can smooth it out. We can iron it out. Don't worry. If we're in charge, we'll be able to iron it out. So it's really a power play. They say, put us in charge and we'll be able to iron all this out. Don't worry. It's very seductive. You see, traditions, the bridge is just a means to an end. Once you cross the bridge, you're not interested in bridges anymore. There are no bridges in the omniverse of perfection. Bridges too are a dream. Bridges too are an absurdity. It's the necessity for bridges is only because we're still trying to gain merit. We're still in an absurdist context. See, we think that having both truth and absurdity be true is not an absurdist context. Because we say, well, we're trying to get rid of the bad absurdity, so it's not really absurdity. This is not true. It is not true. So from that standpoint, then bridges are necessary, right? But bridges, we're finished when we realize that bridges themselves aren't really necessary at all, because absurdity, all absurdity is equally absurd. There's no such thing as absurdity that is true at all. None. And when we're willing to accept that, we're dwelling then in the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. We're there. We're already there, but we don't realize it because we're in this, trying to have this other perspective, which is really attempt to gain merit, which is really a sneaky way to be greater than God, try to be greater than God. To say that we're less, say, hey, God, we what you create is perfect, is actually still needs to gain some merit, is a way to try to be greater than God. And we try to make this seem reasonable by claiming that we're not perfect. Oh, look at us, God, we're a mixture of truth and absurdity. But we're getting rid of the bad absurdity. We're gaining merit. We're practicing. This is still just a sneaky way of trying to be greater than God. Because if we see our perfection, we realize that there isn't any merit that can possibly be gained in any which way. This vision of oneness, you see, merit is absurd. The whole notion of merit is completely absurd, which then ultimately makes practice absurd, which makes all traditions absurd at some point too. But pragmatically, bridges are a pragmatic temporary necessity. So we don't say coexist, we say get whatever bridge you take, get across it as fast as possible. Okay. And tolerate the other bridges, but don't take your bridge and get across it. Very different message than the yoga girls. Very different message. But they're very good at confusing the difference. This is their expertise. And emphasis on tease, because they're able to tease you into this confusion. Yeah, yoga girls have this teasing attitude. It's part of the... part of their repertoire, okay, to say the least. Flirtatious, teasy, but there's a way of teasing you out of your clarity, to tease you out of the clarity. You've got to stay away from that. They're very, very good at engaging you in a teasing way, like a playful teasing way. But that is their expertise in starting to blur your clarity, starting to blur your clarity. So, Chandra Tsering, children, was laughing at my practicing. And Jesus is saying, why do you need to practice? You don't need to practice for me. I don't need you to practice. I want to see you hit the ball. I don't need to see you practice at all. See, this is a totally different. This is not a yoga girl at all. This is someone who realizes no practice is necessary, who's abiding in that omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. Very different than a yoga girl. And yet, female form. See, female form. So female form doesn't mean you have to be a yoga girl. Does not. Does not. There's the proof right there. Yoga girl arises from the second perspective of trying to make both truth and lies true. And it arises from their desire to have power. They thinking that if they play along with this third perspective of absurdity, all, you know, pure absurdity, if they play along with that and deliver, shepherd those from the second perspective of truth and absurdity being true, if they shepherd them into absurdity, they're going to be rewarded because only they could do this. And so they're going to feel superior, and they think that's contentment. They want to feel superior. This is Eve's great sin, you know, great problem. We have to be very careful. This has been pointed out. Judeo-Christianity pointed this out, that the sin of Eve is superiority, which ultimately gets back to arrogance. We want to be superior to God. So they think they're seeing, here's an opportunity to feel the superiority we want to do is deliver this second perspective over to this third absurdist perspective, and then we will be hailed as the great saviors, that we were the ones who brought this about. Of course, those from the other trends, like the artificial intelligence, roboticism, reptilian trends, and various things, they think they're the ones who brought it about. So there will be this power struggle, very much so, power struggle of who's going to rule the roost. Doesn't matter. It's all terrible, you know. But they say, no, as soon as we sort this out, everything will be fine. Good luck with that. But the yoga girls are positioning themselves, saying, we'll be the ecumenical ones in an absurdist belief system. and you'll need us. And don't worry, we're very spiritual. We picked up some Tibetan words, some Hindu words, all these different terminologies, Zen terminology. We picked this up. We can dress the part. We can hold the postures and everything. And so we'll bring this ecumenicalism into absurdity, and you will need us. Otherwise, there's all this factualism that will happen. So they're positioning themselves to be the, you know, the goddess power of this. And they're saying you can't function without us. So, I know they may succeed at that. I don't know. It doesn't really matter, does it? It's much ado about nothing. Or maybe the reptilians will crack down, you know. They think they can seduce the reptilians. Tease them. Tease them out of their position. Seduce them. It's seduction. They're experts at seduction. They feel they can seduce the reptilians. And the Zeta Reticulans, and the Nordics, and, you know, all the various ET factions that are also coalescing on this planet now. They're part of these trends, mental trends of absurdity coalescing upon this planet. Oh, that's why they say there's something great is going to happen on this planet, some unbelievable universe of universal importance. All these trends are converging. They're all converging here. And it's true that all these absurdist trends are converging here. And they feel that when they all converge, some metamorphosis, a transmutation, alchemy, something very profound is going to happen here. And we will have pure absurdity. Just all absurdity will be seen as good. And the yoga girls are saying, but I still see that there may be factionalism, so you're going to need us to hold us together. Because it's, you know, good. So we're centric to what you're doing. Without us, it's not going to work. So they're bargaining, you know, they're angling for power, is what the yoga girls are doing in this new world order. They're very much angling for power. And they say, look, you need to set up a goddess, mother goddess centric, to hold the ecumenical, hold it together, to hold the factionalism down. You got to worship us. This is the card that they're playing. Okay, so there will be these goddesses who are worshipped in the New World Order, most definitely. I don't want to name names, but I already have in this previous video, but I try to stay away from that because there are many who are involved in this, but you know, there's some examples are pretty doggone blatant, very blatant, actually. And I thank them for their blatancy, actually. It's a blessing. I mean, it's maybe they are double agents. It's possible. Sabotaging the yoga girl movement by being so blatant about it. You know, this is a possibility, so I don't want to out them too much. I thank them for being so blatant, though. I'll tell you that. It was very helpful. Interesting perspective, huh? Double agents. Got to keep the door open. That was a possibility. But there's some that have been so blatant about it. They literally have said, look, the purpose of men is to worship women, to put them on a pedestal, to bow down to them and see them that they're the goddess. And to follow their advice explicitly, and they are blatantly angling to be goddesses in the New World Order, blatantly, and they're saying this is how it's going to be. This is what we're taking you, and this is what all teachings are really all about anyway. Like, wow, could you be any more blatant? But thank you for being so blatant. It's awesome. Now, it may just be their ego had run amok, or they may be these very brilliant Dakini secret agents being blatant to alert us. I hope so. I hope that's true. Because it certainly was very, very helpful. So some of these screw-ups are actually the most, very helpful, you know, really. And you wonder if they're not double agents. Playing the role of the bad, the heavy, the, you know, but really saying, hey, look, this is where it's going. This is where it's going. I'm just showcasing it, how bad it's going to be, you know. And that's it. It's possible. So, I always leave the door up to redacting anything I've said in that regard, you know, of saying, pointing out these numbskulls that seem to have been misleading us. They may have been double agents just being so blatant about it, it got our attention. We say, and it showed us, wow, this is where it's going, you know. These egomaniacs may be double agents, I don't know. But again, I've been helped by them greatly to see, wow, don't want that. So these yoga girls definitely are expecting to be worshipped and idolized, and they're going to have all power. I call them the Vestal Virgins, really. I mean, there's this whole class of Vestal Virgins that this is their aim. It, you know, who had the most power in Rome? See, this is an interesting question. The Romans being rather reptilian in orientation. Niburian, you know, I mean, Planet Xian. I mean, the Romans, the hierarchy of the Romans are pretty interesting. And their pantheon of, you know, the gods and goddesses. There was a shared power there between the Vestal Virgins and the goddess worshiping, you know, of that, Osiris. And I mean Isis and Osiris, Vestal Virgins, and the reptilian, you know, the Roman legions, the emperor in charge of the legions and the military and the Senate. There was this sort of sharing of power there, but the Vestal Virgins actually had the most power. They could any, like a death sentence that the emperor imposed, they could commute it like that. And anyone that they sentenced to death, the emperor could not commute. So they had the power of life of death over everyone, the Vestal Virgins. They're just one rule that they had. They had to be virgins. And if they violated that rule, then they were buried alive. And some of them were. Some of them weren't caught. Some of them were caught. The ones that were caught, and they could prove it. You know, they were. What they do is they build a room with all very nice room underground, with all food and nice amenities and luxury and everything, and then they just seal the room off with concrete, stones, dirt, you know, just completely sealed off. And that's it. I guess you run out of oxygen pretty quickly in that circumstance. Right? So, the Vestal Virgins know how to share the power with the reptilians, actually. So they're very confident. They're very confident that they can do this. Very confident they can do this. They say, oh, we've done it before, we'll do it again. But this is just the tip. The Vestal Virgins is the tip of the iceberg of the matriarchy, the goddess, mother goddess complex, you know, that they feel that they are higher. They have the power in life and death. They're higher. They know how to seduce the reptilians. This is what they feel. They know how to control it. And they feel that they're going to be able to do that again. It's like deja vu all over again. And they have their ladies in waiting, of course. Those are many. This yoga girl thing is they're preparing to be these ladies in waiting of royal aristocratic in the land of all this, you know, New World Order, of all this pure equality, of course, the bureaucrats, there will be this massive hierarchy of power, as there always is, the Politburo. And on top of them will be these yoga girls, these goddesses with all their yoga girl coterie, you know, ladies in waiting, court, the court of the yoga girls, to keep everything smoothed out, and they will be worshipped, and temples will be built. Where's it? Temples will be built, all sorts of places to go worship them, like in the past, you know, the pagan past. It'll be like the pagan times again. Only this will be, you know, more materialism, more sophisticated materialism. And their world, their word will be law. Under certain, you know, there's certain rules about that. But you know, there's something, if you gaze upon a Vestal Virgin, there's you put to death. If you're certain, there's certain in Rome, there were certain things you couldn't do, or you would be instantly condemned to death in terms of the Vestal Virgin. So they will have the power of life and death over everyone. With some wiggle room at the top for the, you know, the top dogs. Of course, there's always some wiggle room up there, right? Where you might be condemned to death, but it they can also commute that, you know. So the emperor, like, yes, the emperor too, the Vestal Virgins condemn them to death. But there's a wiggle room where they say, well, yeah, but give us more power. We also have the power to commute your death sentence too. And so they'll tell the emperor what to do and say, if you do this, ah, you're now on the good, in the good graces of the Vestal Virgin, so we commute your sentence, and you're just like that. So this is how politics works in this pagan system. That's how politics works. So the Vestal Virgins can keep, say, everyone saves face. They still have the power over everyone, including the emperor, including the top bureaucrats, and everyone. And yet, in order for them to keep their power, they need the emperor and all this others, they need them. So they can't seem to be arrogant or arbitrary or too high and mighty. So they, if the emperor does something they don't like, they can condemn to death, but then also tell them how to make amends. And then this filtered down the rest of the people. Look, you can sin against us, but here's a way to commute the sin against us. It's a patriarchal belief system, absurdity, based on all absurdity is good. Don't worry, the mother can make it all good. She knows the way to make absurdity, to make you content with absurdity. And you have these goddesses who are the images of idols of contentment. Beautiful temples, all the ladies in waiting are so beautiful. The yoga ladies are there chanting, and the goddess is dressed up so beautiful, you know, headdresses and all this, and seated on the sumptuousness everywhere, and, you know, life of ease and contentment, everything. And people say, oh, she is truly content. Mother does know how to make us content with absurdity. This is the illusion, the play. It's all theater. It's a theater of the absurd. Is really what it is. It's theater of the absurd, is what this option the yoga girls are offering us. Theater of the absurd. They say, don't worry, we'll do it really well. Well, yeah. Until the goddess gets an allergy, you know. She can't see it today. What's wrong? Well, she's communing with she's in a high state of bliss or something. And really, she's back there screaming at her yoga girl aide, you know, get rid of this allergy. Don't you have some compounds that'll get rid of it? This terrible. How can I appear? How can I keep this theater of the absurd going on? You know, they're divas. I mean, these goddesses are really just divas. They're just actresses. It's all theater of the absurd. This is the truth. This is, eventually you see this. But, you know, people are caught up in theater and stuff. You know where they're going. I'm not caught up in that at all. Ananda, my ma, helped me with all that. She put me through the theater of the absurd, the whole goddess, yoga girl, all this stuff, so I could get a feel for what it's all about, you know, and it's like, oh gosh, theater of the absurd. So, but I stopped watching entertainment and all this stuff. It doesn't interest me anymore. She put me through this theater of the absurd with her as the goddess, so that I would then realize what this whole goddess worship thing is really about. And then she said, don't worry, you'll forgive me at some point. And I said, okay, I know I will. So she's so confident. We both knew, okay, all right, I will forgive you for putting me through this and getting upset with you and all this. And eventually I will. I'm not quite there yet. Because it was really, very intense of putting her on a pedestal and all this and the goddess, the whole goddess thing. I said, "Why didn't you teach me truly?" And stuff. Well, she said, "Well, then you wouldn't have gone through this, right?" I mean, she said some absurd stuff, actually. She said, "But then you wouldn't have been willing to go through this whole, play, so you could see what it's all about." So it was a very brilliant, spiritually brilliant thing, that she, that Anandamayi was doing. Very, 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 very amazing. And eventually, it will all be forgiven in terms of, okay, bruised feelings, it bruised my feelings for sure. Because I realized, hey, you're not the goddess. What is this, And then she went quiet, pretty much. So I was like, wow, why'd you put me through all this? If you're not, you're not the goddess, well, now I'm seeing, because this was then, freeing me from the lure of the yoga girls, luring me into this new world order, which is absurdist, completely absurdist. It helped dull the edge of all that, dulled it all for me. And she did this. She said, "You want to play with, dress me up as a goddess? Go ahead. Okay, I'll let you do it." She allowed all her devotees to do that. She encouraged it. She allowed it for it. And so they did. But then her attitude was detached from it all. And the benefit of this led down the road, you realize, hey, I've already been there, done that. It's not really that interesting. It doesn't really attract me anymore. So I'm not interested in the New World Order. It doesn't really hold any juice for me. Even the yoga girls don't hold enough juice for me. And their goddess worshiping. It's just theater of the absurd, just these silly actresses with allergies. Imagine just the goddess with the terrible allergies. Okay, a Kleenex, give it, just, I can't appear before my people with this horrible allergy. Give me more makeup, give me more makeup. God, don't you have something that will knock out this allergy so I can at least appear? Oh my God, this are just like a diva, in a play. Her voice goes bad. I can't sing, I can't sing. How can I get out there? Give me something for my voice. Get rid of this, cold. And she's screaming at her attendants, don't you idiots have something? So at that point, the diva, the goddess thing, isn't so nice to her yoga girl attendants. She turns into this witch. I mean, horrible witch. She's panicking. Get me something. That's your job. You're supposed to know how to take care of this for me. How can I do all this stuff with you people? Are you incompetent? I need this now. That's your whole job, is make sure I. And then the yoga girl's like, yes, mother, yes, mother, yes, mother. Get the compound. Don't you have something? They're experts in compounds. Medications too. The yoga girls are very. Are you a Vedic? I have this. All these essences. Oh, get her the essence. Don't you have something? Don't worry, don't worry. Take this, take this, take this. And the goddess says, well, I feel better. I better feel better. She says, oh yeah, don't worry, don't worry. You'll feel better. And like the yoga girls are like sweating bullets, just like suddenly their beautiful world is like, they're freaking out. Like, oh my God, what if she doesn't get better from this allergy? Horrible. And then when it works, they say, miracle, goddesses, thank God. Well, they actually say, at that point, they say, thank God. Not thank goddess. Thank God you calmed her down, That's when they remember God. They don't say thank goddess at that point. They say, thank God you calmed her down. I don't know what you did, but our necks, we're going to face the guillotine if we didn't get her voice back. Holy cow, that was a close one. So it's really, they say, uneasy the head that wears the crown. Well, it's uneasy the heads that attend to the one who wears the crown. That is for sure. And so these yoga girls wanted to use me as their consultant, side consultant when the goddess got a cold or something, and they didn't know how to treat it. They wanted to consult me, like, hey, we, you know, our account compounds aren't working. What do we do? What do we do? You know, maybe their New York accent will break through at that point. You know, it's like, hey, you know, she got, we got to fix her up, or we're next. You know, we're toast. I mean, yeah, we don't really, you know, our magic isn't working so good. Could you please help us? Could you please do something? Oh my gosh, just, yeah, help, help, help. You know, they wanted to use me for that. You know, do a miracle. Well, we may still do these miracles to help the yoga girls out in that way, possibly. I don't know. But I'm not going to hang around this world to do it. They don't have to. They're not going to put me here and say, you got to stay. No, you know, if I need to come around somewhere, if I need to be around, I'll be around. That kind of thing. Even the yoga girls need mercy. Even the theater of the absurdity needs mercy, right? Just push all. It's simple. Miracles are simple, actually. They want to know how to do the miracles. Can, you know, they don't seem to be working for us. Well, of course. Because you're trying to have it pure absurdity. And pure absurdity is a very, very jealous mistress. Very much so. And says, you can't do it that way. How dare you go consult someone? You don't need that. Shh, don't tell anybody we consulted you. You know, that's taboo. So you got to be this anonymous person, you know, that's this terrible wretch, you know, garbage person. Supposed to, we don't want. And if someone says, oh, the ladies and white yoga girls went and consulted him to know how to cure you, goddess, he goes, what? You know, and they'll say, no, we didn't do that. Are you, no, are you kidding? Why would we go to this garbage person who's nobody here and ask them? That's ridiculous. What a lie. We were just teasing him. You know, what an idiot he was. No, we didn't go to him. And then the goddess will say, oh, yeah, okay. I can see he's nothing. So, okay, I'll believe you this time. This is what they've done. This is what the yoga girls have done. They say, if you want to help us, this is how you have to be. Well, I'd say resign as a yoga girl. Resign. Oh, but we're so used to attending upon a goddess. Well, then attend upon Anandamayi Ma. Then if you want to attend on a goddess, then she'll help iron out your issues. Like that. Right? That's why I tried to introduce Anandamayi Ma to help the yoga girls. I said, look, this, if you want to attend upon a goddess, she'll play that game with you. You can play that game. But she's not really a goddess. Okay? She's like a double agent out in the open. You know, kind of thing. An admitting double agent. Say, sure, you can see me as a goddess, but I'm not really a goddess. She was honest about it. Everyone that met her say, oh, you're our goddess has come to see us. Finally, our goddess has come to see us. And she smiled. Can we dress you up as our goddess? She goes, sure. So they'd dress her up. And then they'd worship her as the form of worship, or as their goddess. All the different forms of worship. And she'd just smile and just be looking up like this. Gazing into the eternal omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. Just as that, gazing as that. So they'd dress her up and they'd worship her and they'd say, oh, you're bringing so many blessings to us. This is so amazing. And then she said, okay, well, I got to go now. And they say, what? No. Here's your temple. Here's your worshipers. You're home. You finally came home to us. We've been waiting for you for so long. You can't leave. And she goes, well, I can't help myself. I simply have to go. This is how I can't really explain it, but, you know, she said it's just, I'm being called to move on from the great grace that I can't explain, but this is just what I have to do. Well, they would plead with her, no, no, no. And they get all the yoga girls would come out and say, Ma, 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 we are your attendants. You can't leave your attendants, Ma. It's impossible. How can you leave us there? That's exactly what happened. They say, Ma, 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 you're our goddess mother. You can't leave us here. We, you know, what did we do wrong? She goes, well, I'm with you always. Don't worry. I will be with you always. Don't worry. And then she said, I'll tell you what, here's, you do these practices and this will help you remind you that I'm with you always. And these, of course, these practices would help orient them towards ultimate truth, towards truth. And so she's a very, the greatest double agent of all time, to say the least. She was, Anandamayi was a double agent for sure. But an open one, the greatest one of all time, ever, in my opinion. She wouldn't say, no, I'm not a goddess. She'd allow them to believe it, and then she'd say, well, I got to leave you now, and then say, okay, do this in memory of me, and I'm with you always. And then she'd use that or to turn them around towards truth. And then the people say, well, definitely there's this wonderful, perfect spiritual goddess, you know. So we just experienced it, but she left. How's that possible? Of course, what she was pointing out was their absurdity, their loyalty to absurdity is what was causing them to leave her. Okay, she says, I'm with you always. There's nowhere I can go. What are you talking about, leaving? She'd say, leave? I'm everywhere. I can't even turn around. How can I leave everywhere? I'm everywhere. I'm not leaving you. I've never gone anywhere. She said, I've never gone anywhere. So, she's this brilliant double agent. Absolutely brilliant double agent. And she keeps playing this role, so we can't really, you know, I just want to say thank you, you know, but she still is, historically, is in this role of a double agent. So I can't say, no, you really weren't this, you didn't believe any of the stuff you were doing, you know, I know what you were up to. But I can't quite present her that way, you know, because everybody will say, oh, Ma, you're my goddess, mother, okay, you know. So I can't really show what I see, you know, that it's just, I see behind the curtain. I know what you're really about. It's frustrating. I want to show people, this is the real Anandamayi Ma. This is what she, I mean, this, and they say, no, Ma, you're so beautiful, you're so lovely, you're a goddess, you're going to make us happy. But then she laughed. What? She laughed, you know. Oh, I know, it's terrible. Oh my gosh, yeah. But okay, we'll have a shrine to her. That's why she said, leave me out of this, because she's a double agent. Playing that role of, it's really ecumenicalism, of helping all these different factions of different goddess worshippers, which is even in absurdity and in the third perspective, the second perspective that I talked about, perspective A, B, C, there's always factionalism. Many, 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 many goddesses. So she was helping this factionalism go to more ecumenicalism, right? Cross the bridges towards the vision of oneness. Very, very helpful with that. So on a deep level, she was extremely helpful. But on the superficial level, people automatically tend to see her as a woman, beautiful woman, goddess-like figure, etc. Even though she insisted, it's funny that you not see her this way. It's funny because even those who see her this way will tell. They'll just be honest. Say, well, she actually. I was listening to one of her devotees talk, and she said, "Oh yeah, Ma's wonderful, beauty, you know this and oh yeah." And then she said, "But actually, she told us, don't see us as the mother. This is very. That was one of her main things. She says, if I ask one thing of you, please, I'm pleading with you, do not see me as the mother." Do not see me as the mother. She said, that is very, very spiritually wrong. Because you're distancing yourself. It's a very distancing defense you use, which is what absurdity does, distance itself from what? The omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. Absurdity uses the notion of time and space, process and form, to distance itself from that. And so it sets up this mother goddess as a distancing tool, defense. And so she would say, don't see me as the mother, see me as your child, if you must, or just as your friend, your brother, your sister, see me as your sister. And it says, even better than that, just see me as your friend. Which is exactly what Jesus said as he, when he came back last spring, 2:15. I'm here to relate with you as your friend, as a friend, as your friend, okay? That's it. That's what Ananda my mom also said. And yet, those who were attracted to her, they kept saying, oh, no, ma, yeah. But she helped thin that out, you know. She helped thin it out. She helped transmute a lot of that. And some of her, you know, some of the ones she helped most, like for me, are not even a Hindu at all. Not even, never even saw her over there. Never, and never approached it from that angle at all. And worked very sort of spiritually, intuitively, working through the whole goddess worship thing. Just, she's not, wasn't even present here as the body in the world, but she was able to help me from, quote unquote, beyond the grave to work through all this just on my own. So people claim, well, she was a Hindu. Well, see, they want to claim her. They wanted to claim the India, the whole yoga girl thing, tried to claim her, and they wanted to use her as the figurehead, as the goddess. This thing, you see, you'll smooth out absurdity for us. And she refused. She refused it. Refused it. They put all the pressure in the world on her, and she could have everything. They'd say they'd build her the greatest temples the world has ever seen. Literally, she was given this. You have all the money, all the temples, all, we'll put you on the dollar bill. You're going to be the figurehead of our currency. You're going to be the global figurehead. India is going to be the global spiritual nation leading the world of the New World Order spiritually, and you'll be the figurehead of it all. And you will be the prime goddess, the top in the whole world, and we will give you all these yoga girl attendants, and we will have this massive worldwide religion centered on you. They offer all of this to her, which is very reminiscent of the temptation of Jesus. How Lucifer tempted Jesus with all the power of the kings of the world, I'll give you everything. Ananda Maima literally had that put on her platter right in front of her, and they were very serious. And she just laughed. She blessed them and thank you so much. And she says, I'm just a silly little girl. That's all I am. How can I do this for you? It's so wonderful that you think so highly of me, but I'm really just a silly little girl. You know, is all I am. And I could never be like this. And they say, no, ma, you're this great goddess. She says, no, I'm really just a crazy, silly little girl who acts silly a lot of times, actually. She says, I don't know how I'm going to act next. I mean, how can I be this great goddess and run this great bureaucracy and this world, great world religion and everything when I don't even know what I'm going to do next? I might start acting silly at some point, you know? That wouldn't work at all, would it? I'm so sorry, I can't do this for you. I just can't do this for you, no. And so she turned him down very nicely, as she was able to do. And of course she was crying, and she'd be crying, inconsolable, you know. I let you down, I'm so sorry. And they say, oh, don't cry. Of course they were very upset she turned him down. They had Mahatma Gandhi give his best try, absolutely. He tried to imprison her, actually, in his compound, and so they could brainwash her. And she told him she had to leave. And he says, nobody leaves my compound unless I give him permission. And she goes, I'm so sorry, Father, that I'm going to disappoint you, because I'm going to leave with even without your permission. And I know you may be very angry at me, but please don't be angry at me, because I have a little craziness in me. I'm not always able to do what people in authority tell me to do. You just have to look at it as some sort of trouble that I have. I'm not able to control what I'm going to do and say, and it's just beyond my capacity to please everybody. So I just ask for your forgiveness. and leaving without your authority. And Gandhi was like, he didn't know what to say. He said, nobody defies my authority in the compound. And he, of course, he was surrounded by yoga girls. Mahatma Gandhi was absolutely surrounded by yoga girls. And they ran things very tight ship. And he said, told them, go talk to Ma. She's going to leave. And I can't have this figurehead. I'm the figurehead. You can't have me defied her. The whole thing will, people will view us differently. You can't have her leave. So they pleaded with her. They went to him and pleaded, Ma, don't leave. You're making him look bad. And he's the center of Indian spiritual revival. And you're going to undermine it. She says, I'm so sorry, she says, but I'm not able to control my movements where I go. It's not under my control. It's all God's grace that's doing it. I act badly at times, she says, or whatever, however you want to see it. I'm so sorry, you know. And they couldn't prevail upon her, you know. They did their utmost. And so she left this compound. And that was it, as far as the yoga girls were concerned with her. I mean, she was on the outs with them at that point. They turned their attention other directions. So they didn't like that, to say the least. Just like Jesus saying no to Lucifer, well, there was those who didn't like that, you know, that he refused to be the Messiah, the materialistic Messiah that they were hoping for, that would get rid of the bad absurdity for them. Part of Judaism at that point, you know, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, there was this option B, perspective B, of trying to get rid of the bad absurdity, which is why the temple sacrifice, all that stuff, that was designed to get rid of the bad absurdity and keep the good absurdity. So they wanted Jesus to be the Messiah of their kingdom, of where both truth and good absurdity are both there, you know. And he said, no, I didn't come for that. And they were very upset, and they offered him to be the figurehead of this kingdom. And he turned him down. And from that point, you know, that was that they were after him, but that didn't sit well with them. They thought that he was completely observant. They say, oh, see, you're one of those completely observist. He says, no, I'm completely non-absurdist. He said, no, that's not possible. We need to get rid of the bad absurdity, but the good absurdity is great. You know, that's part of, that's truth also. That's a second truth. We've been able to create a second truth. And we did it by getting rid of the bad, purifying the second truth. We said, yeah, we admit that the second truth wasn't pure to start with, but through sacrifice and all that stuff, we've been able to purify the second truth. So now, you know, we have these two truths. They're both true, equally true. And Jesus said, no, that is not so. They didn't like that. That's not so. And so they insisted he must be siding with the absurdists, and he wasn't. So that's a big problem with the option B here, is they think that those are in option A, which is just truth is true. They think that they're absurd, complete absurdists, not able to recognize the second truth that we've been able to create. See, we're thinking that being a co-creator with God means we get to create a second truth, our own truth. That's not what it means. Being a co-creator with God means we get to extend the one truth, which is this omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. We get to extend that. You see, we're part of that. We're part of that extending, that eternal extension of all that, never ending. It doesn't mean we get to create our own truth. That's where we went wrong. So Jesus was offered the temptation. Anand Mahima was also offered this temptation. They both passed that test, absolutely, to say the least. Others have been offered the temptation as well, to be a figurehead, right? But in the case of Anand Mahima, the new figurehead of the New World Order is going to be female. And so they saw her as the perfect figurehead. And by turning him down, she helped so many in this world say, hey, wait a minute. These yoga girls are up to no good. I'm suspicious of it. Great double agent. Great double agent. Here's the goddess. She's finally come. Whoops. She turns down the role. What? It's like that. What? Huh. Shocker. Here's our God has come to finally to see us and dwell with us in our temple. And she's leaving us? What? Shocker. Why? How is this possible? Then they start really... It's deep, something deep within them is like all reverberating, like keeps reverberating. I need to, what's going on? What's going on? I thought I had figured it all out. I thought this is it. And it's not it. Oh my gosh. Great, great double agent. Double agent. Ananda Maima. Perma Brahmanarayana, as she admitted to her closest associate who insisted that she tell, who are you really? You know, her close yoga girl aides, she drove them crazy. I mean, they were upset. She had these top yoga girl aides. And they said, Ma, you're going to do what we tell you to do. I mean, we're helping you out. And she keep giving them the slip and drove them crazy. Through all these laws, you know, rules, regulations, you got to do this, 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 and then she'd break them and rules or go around them and just, the major one, Guru Priya Didi, I believe she begged and begged. She was always basic begging Ma to tell her, who are you really? Because she knew, you know, the stuff that she couldn't, this play, it was a double agent, she played it so perfectly, it was just driving Guru Priya Didi nuts. She said, who are you really? Come on. You act like a goddess and then you give them the slip and you're not. And, you know, what is this play? Who's playing here? What, you know? And Ma said, don't ask me who I am. Don't ask me to tell you. Don't ask me to tell you, please. Please don't ask me to tell you who I am. And she's serious about that. She said she didn't want to say who she was because that would blow her cover as a double agent, you know? And so finally, Guru Priya Didi prevailed upon her, and Ananda Maima says, I'm Purna Brahma Narayana. Which means ultimate truth. But then she started crying and crying and crying and just absolutely went into hysterics crying about it. Then Guru Priya Didi then said, okay, I'm not going to focus on that. All right. She tries to drop it. In other words, drop it. So, but Ananda Maima did say that she was, you know, the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection, present here, in, you know, having a bodily appearance. She was the absolute, wasn't a goddess at all, wasn't actually a goddess at all. It was just this is theater of the absurd, double agent theater of the absurd. Is what she did. Perfect actress. Played the role of the perfect actress. Kept slipping out of the role. Played the role perfectly, then slip out of the role. And so Guru Priya Didi said, who are you really? Are you this goddess or what are you? Are you the absolute or what is this? And it's funny because the devotees are now, there's a movie coming out in maybe 2017, if we ever get there, in the footsteps of Ananda Maima, or something like that, or there's a documentary movie coming out, I can't remember the name of it, but that talks with the devotees of her, and recounts their experiences. You know, the idea of a movie, we think, well, it's going to be a couple hours or something. No, I mean, why should a movie only be a couple hours? You're talking about this subject matter. Let it be 15 hours long. I don't know how long you can upload something on YouTube, but I could find out, you know? I could find out, but you might be able to upload a movie that's, you know, 15 hours long. Anyway, they have these excerpts of devotees, and so some of these excerpts are being put on YouTube, and I'm viewing them, and they're very wonderful. And these devotees say, "Look, we were with her," and devotees, and he says, "But we were all very," so there were these very strong masculine type yoga girls as her central handlers who were very intimidating. And they said, "We were all terrified of them. They ran a very tight ship." And they're talking about Guru Priya, Devi. They're very tough. Very tough, kind of, authoritative masculine, but also feminine cleverness, feminine. I mean, they had this. So they were intimidators. I mean, they scared these devotees. Everyone says this. They went to see her. They said, "Wow, he's running a strict ship here. I mean, strict ship. You had to do things their way." Because I think that they, in their own mind, they were hoping that she would be this figurehead. And they were hoping they could keep her here for that. And they felt if they just ran things right, it would work. And there was a certain amount of despair in them. I look at Guru Priya Devi and I see despair in her. Really. It's funny. You look at those closest to her and the yoga girls who were handling the whole thing, and they did a great job in helping out. But there was some despair in them. You could see the frustration and despair, actually. That's obvious. It's obvious. They were like saying, "We're failing, we're failing, we're failing." So deep down, they were hoping that they could, there's still some, that they were still had some absurdity in them, and they were hoping that maybe she was the answer into this new world order of India being this great spiritual powerhouse, and the great Bharat of the Vedic times would arise and be this ruler of the world. And there's all this stuff that was there in India, the independence movement, everything. They were hoping that she would be this goddess that would stay with them because they knew she could. She could be eternally young. They knew that because they've had evidence of it. And they told her, "Ma, you can stay here as long as you want. We know this is a fact. Why are you choosing to leave us? This is something that was just driving them nuts." They couldn't accept it. Because it was a fact. It is a fact that she could have stayed, the body can stay here in appearance as long as, in perpetuity, as long as we want, actually. In perfect condition. Jesus has told us this. This is true. And again, there are many instances where people would see suddenly that her bodily appearance of aging would just completely disappear, and they'd see her as just completely this young, fresh, perfectly healthy, no trace of aging on her whatsoever, and then she'd just be smiling at them and saying, "Yeah, this is, I can be like this, absolutely I can. But you want me to age and die, so that's why you're seeing that." So these handlers, they wanted her to stay and be this goddess, and she was aging, and she kept, they couldn't control her. And this bothered them a great deal, and they hoped that by having all these rules and regulations and following strictly the Ayurvedic this and the Vedic this and strict 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 strict, that they could keep her here. And so Anandamayi Ma didn't want to blow her cover, so she went along with it, but she also went around it. I've told you stories of how she would try to. She heard these devotees, these male devotees. There was some female-only thing. They tried to arrange. Only females can go here. She arranged for a male to go there, and she goes, "Yeah, you can't do that, Ma. You can't do that." And then she'd make up some excuse. She'd always find ways around the yoga girls, because they tried to throw impediments in her way. And it says, "No, that we're setting up this goddess-centric thing where only women have access to you at the highest level." And so they set up ceremonies and everything. And sometimes she'd invite men to them, and they would, the yoga girls would say, no, you can't, you can't do that. No males allowed." And she would frighten them in some way, like, "Oh, I'm dying," or something. They say, "No, you can't die." She'd always play that card, I'm dying. And they do that. She could, because she'd drop, she turned to a corpse in front of them before, on various occasions, where it's a rotting corpse. And so they knew that she would do it, so it scared the heck out of them. And so they said, no, okay. She says, we'll make an exception for this guy, this man. I said, okay, we'll make an exception, but, you know, okay. So she drove them nuts, you know, because they were trying to control her and turn her into this new age goddess with them as the controllers, where no men were allowed. They were Vestal Virgins, so they're trying to set themselves up as Vestal Virgins and empower that through her, claiming that she had empowered this. See, very interesting. That she would play dead. She would play the death card on him. He said, well, how are you going to have me as this figurehead if I'm dead? And they go, well, we know that you won't leave us. She says, well, I've left everybody else. How do you know I won't leave you? And they say, oh, yeah, that's right. Well, but you wouldn't do that to us. And she says, really? I'm feeling sick right now. You know, and feeling, and then start freezing up. And, no, don't freeze up. She says, well, My will, my kaol is to have these men attend this, see me at this point, and you're claiming that they can't. So my kaol is then saying that I have no function here, so I'm going to die. And then they go, they're just like, shoot, okay, we'll let the men attend, but only this time. She was doing that all the time, actually. This is the real story of Ananda Maimai. The story you're getting through these devotees is the sanitized version of it all. I dug deeper into the whole thing. There were some double agents that spilled the beans. I mean, really, what really went on. And I know what really went on. But you're not getting that in these videos. Well, some of the devotees are honest about it. She has wonderful devotees. But the filmmaker, people are trying to sanitize the whole thing. They have a story to tell. And I tried to tell the real story, and nobody was interested in that. Nobody was interested in that. Because the real story is way more compelling. I mean, way more compelling, isn't it? They want to try to use her memory as a way to empower the New World Order yoga girls, but it's not working for them. It's not working well for them. It's not working well for them. Just like it didn't work well for Guru Priya Devi, you know, and her Bengali yoga girls. But Ananda Maimai allowed all that. She needed to. That was part of the theater. It's part of the play. I would, if I was there, I would just say, I don't need to ask who you are. It's obvious who you are. I won't say anything, though. I would have spilled the beans, you know. You're a double agent, obviously. I know what you're doing. But you'd say, shh, don't say anything. Let me play my play, please. Okay. But it's pretty hard to do that. You want to say, So that's the real story of Ananda Maimai. I could tell the real story of Ananda Maimai, but I don't think she wants me to. I don't know. Maybe she will at some point allow me to do that. That might be the title of the video, The Real Story of Ananda Maimai, The Divine Double Agent. Super agent, sent by God. Sent directly by God, this super divine double agent. Because God knew that we're in this very, very, very dangerous trap right now. Headed straight towards the jaws. And, there's a surf place called Mavericks at Half Moon Bay. And they hold the world's most famous big wave surf contest there called Mavericks. And the thing about Mavericks is it's way like a mile out from shore. And there's like a reef out there, some sort of formation out there, and it causes the waves to break out there, but it only breaks when there's a certain direction of swell coming from a certain direction to catch the reef proper angle. And the swell has to be really big, otherwise it won't break. So you're looking out at the ocean, you say, oh, there's no waves out there, there's nothing out there, nothing to worry about there. We can go out there and with our boats and hang out. Well, every now and then Mavericks does break, and when it breaks, it's like 40-foot waves. Some of the nastiest waves in the world. I mean, the world's greatest surfer, Kelly Slater, surfed their Mavericks in 1999 and got pounded by one of these waves and held underwater. And he said it was the most craziest thing he's ever experienced, like an underwater waterfall, a waterfall underwater. Just said it drove him so deep, and he's never surfed there since. It's super dangerous. At least two surfers in contests have been killed there. I don't know if there's others that have lost their lives there. I imagine there have been. It is very, a supremely dangerous wave to surf. You get held down too long. You hit the bottom too severely and all this stuff. So this is like the trends in the world right now. We're looking, we say, oh, look at the ocean. It's so nice. It's so nice. Yeah. Well, there's a big swell coming in, and the swells are converging, and the swell's going to hit it just the right angle. And suddenly, poof, 40-foot waves are suddenly going to be there, crushing 40-foot waves. And where in the heck did that come from? This is the problem is we don't see it. But if you know of this surf spot and you know the swell that's coming in, you know it's going to break. So that's like what I'm like. I'm like that. I'm like a surfer. I say, hey, I know these trends are coming in. It's like a swell coming across the ocean. And I know that there's this reef, and I know it's going to hit this reef, and I know it's going to be massive waves. There's no doubt about it. And these waves are going to hold you under so long that you're going to get so confused, you're going to settle for a pure absurdity and trying to be content with that. So it's a dangerous situation coming. And God knows it. God sent it, this super, super, super double agent, divine double agent into the world, and Nanamaima, to help us out with it. And you may think, oh no, she was only came from the Hindus. No, that was just where her play took place. But I'm not a Hindu, and she helped me. She's helped me out tremendously, tremendously, because she introduced herself to me and says, maybe I can be of some help to you here. I said, okay, let's see, let's see, let's go for it. She'll introduce herself to anyone she pleases to. The yoga girls aren't going to tell her who to introduce herself, who she can introduce herself to. I'm sure they are not thrilled she introduced herself to me. Not at all. He said, oh, we want to crush this guy. What do you mean? We don't want you helping him. We want him to help us, but we don't want him to know. You might help free him or something. We don't. We need to help him do miracles and when our magic fails. Otherwise, a goddess is going to send us to the guillotine. So, how are we doing here? Cruising along this video? Okay. Now, we make these videos long simply because we have so much to say of great importance. That's why. This material, for those who have ears, is of extreme importance. More and more and more is coming out every day now. If I saw it on my mind, are you here as a double agent for me now, or a different role? I need to know that. How are you playing it? How are you playing it now? And she might just laugh, and her laughter would continue on and on. Eventually, it would calm me down, and say, okay, I can see what your role is now. I get it. At that point, I'd be okay with it, Because she really put me through the ringer, severely. But it was necessary. Because she was playing the role of what what the New World Order is going to demand of me, you know, would be demanding of me, but did it ahead of time, so I was aware of you know, all the different elements involved, and then could turn it down, could turn the offer down. Thanks, but no thanks. Maybe some other life I will accept this offer. I'm not saying no, categorically no to it, but for the rest of this life, I'm going to, you know, be in bliss, and perhaps in a future life, distant future life, I will re-examine your offer. I'm not categorically turning it down. Some other place, spot in time and space, so to speak. You know, knowing that this is all a dream, and knowing I don't have to exercise that option, but I'm not shutting the door, I'm not slamming the door on them, because we're free to, I'm free to entertain it if I want to. So I'm not going to deny my freedom. So I say, well, I'm free to say yes to your offer at some point, but just I'm not saying, not in this life, I'm not going to. And somehow this video, we're getting extra run, but I think it may stop at some point anyway. So if it does stop, we've had a great run here. The divine, yeah. What she did really also, she turned India away from its insane political, egoic aspirations to rule the world, from the politics, all that, the egoic politics of all that. And she did it through softening up a lot of the women in India who are very powerful women, and turning them towards being devotees of her, who otherwise would have supported the push, the yoga girl push towards India being this world superpower and dominating the world. Really, you have to understand that India wants to dominate the world. I mean, so does China, so does the United States, so does Russia, so does various countries. But India, well, most people don't know this, is a lot of these gurus, you know, so-called gurus, were nationalists, very strong nationalists. Vivekananda, Sri Aurobindo, you know, and various ones. Their purpose was they wanted Bharat to be the dominant country power in the world. And they wanted to justify it through its spiritual strength. They say that we're going to teach you true spirituality, and we need to be the, you know, the world superpower. And so Nanda Maima realized that this is that's perspective B, which is trying to get rid of the bad absurdity. And so she undermined that, sabotaged it, really, by getting a lot of these powerful women to be her devotees. And they stopped supporting this national movement. And of course, women are the real power behind the throne in this world. So if the women decide, we're not so keen on that anymore, well, the men, they lose their momentum. They lose their voice. Men can have very powerful voices if women are supporting them. When women withdraw support, they lose their voice. They become, you know, the Wizard of Oz. So she helped withdraw support from India's nationalism and channel that towards genuine spiritual endeavor. She was like a divine saboteur, actually, in the right way. Like Kamala Nehru, for instance, she tried to soften up Indira Gandhi, who was Nehru's daughter. Her mother was Kamala Nehru. Indira Gandhi's mother was Kamala Nehru, and Jawaharlal Nehru was the father. And Kamala Nehru became a great devotee of Ananda Maima and gave up her spiritual life. I'm sorry, she gave up her political life for a spiritual life. Now, she used to bring Indira Gandhi to see Ananda Maima quite a bit, because Indira Gandhi, of course, was the heart and soul of Indian nationalism and attempt to be a superpower. She was extremely ambitious spirit, egoic spirit, Indira Gandhi, extraordinarily so, very dangerous woman. And she, of course, wanted to create an aristocratic ruling family of based on her. She used her father as a figurehead. And my dad was actually friends with Indira Gandhi, knew her quite well. He didn't ever say this to me. He thought she was wonderful. But Anandamayi was helping soften up Indira Gandhi to a certain extent, as well as Mahatma Gandhi and all these nationalists. She was actually sabotaging them, what they were doing. Not in terms of freedom from the British, no. That had already taken place. But in terms of this disease of nationalism, as Krishnamurti also helped soften up. He was also a saboteur, helped soften up nationalism. Jiddu Krishnamurti, who I met him in spirit. He gave me a minor empowerment. I'm certainly friends with him. And he also helped greatly. But Anandamayi really got to the women of India, the powerful women of India, and turned their attention towards true spiritual aspiration, which helped them undermine the men that they were supporting and lessen their voice and ambition. Lessen the ambition of it all. So she softened the entire ambition, India's ambition to be this secular superpower, which then has greatly helped the overall world turn towards spirituality, because the Hindus can be overbearing when they mix nationalism with spirituality. That's a big problem. Also may have prevented war with nuclear war with Pakistan. We don't know what Anandamayi and Ma did here was probably prevent a nuclear war. A lot of stuff, actually. Because India and Pakistan, there definitely has been the potential for an all-out nuclear war there, and still is. But there were times when it was very close to happening, and if Anandamayi Ma had not come to India, it most likely would have happened, because the virulence of this combination of religion and nationalism would have been way stronger, and the Pakistanis way would have felt threatened to such an extent that they, one of them may have just decided to let's we can't take this threat anymore, and started a nuclear war. Also could have prevented other wars. I mean, India, we think of them as a very spiritual nation. Well, if you look at its past, it's been involved in all sorts of wars. There's also they can mix nationalism with religion better than anyone, and as good as anyone, let's say. So can Islam. But when you mix those two together, together, look out, look out. Very emotional, very, very dangerous. So she was able to soften that nationalism up to a profound extent. It's still bad, but it's nothing like it would have been if, Vivekananda, and it would have had his way, etc. No. No. Softened it all up. And Vivekananda and the various nationalists, that whole current of India's the greatest, we're spiritually superior to everyone, we get to rule the world. This whole thing, which Vivekananda represented, and Sri Aurobindo to some extent, other lot of gurus and a lot of religious people represented that. She undermined that all. She undermined it, sabotaged it all. And she went down to Pondicherry, saw or Sri Aurobindo's spiritual consort, the mother they call her, Mother of Pondicherry, a French lady, who's very powerful nationalist too, helping them out, and wanted to be a goddess figurehead. And they had a very interesting meeting, and it was a power struggle. And the mother of Pondicherry, Aurobindo, Auroville, etc., Mother Auroville, they call her the mother. She said that, no, I'm the divine child. I'm the divine child. I'm the divine child. And I know I said, no, I'm even the smaller diviner. I'm even more of an infant, divine infant than you. And they had this spiritual battle. And Ananda Ma won the battle. You know, she won it. She softened it up. She softened her up. She says, no, you will not break my will, what I'm doing. You will not interfere with what I'm doing. There's definitely a power, so tremendous power struggle between two females there, two spiritual females claiming to be, you know. And it was really something. People witnessed it. People witnessed it. This is a real story of Ananda Maima, I'm telling you. She is very determined. This is a divine secret agent, double agent, saboteur, coming into the world, entirely determined, would not be deterred from her mission. And there's, in my mind, there's no question she averted terrible world war. Temporarily. She bought us some time, actually. Not in my mind, bought us time. And again, she confessed to her closest devotees. They forced her, they insisted on it, that she was Purna Brahma Narayana, meaning the true, absolute, completely abstract God, you know, God above God, so to speak. Parabrahma Narayana, Purna Brahma Narayana, was not really a sectarian God. It was not really Brahma, for instance. Brahma, the Indians worship Brahma, but she said Purna Brahma Narayana or Parabrahma Narayana, in other words, Parabrahman, the pure spaciousness, the pure God, the pure spaciousness, which is completely transcendent of any tradition whatsoever. Not really a Hindu at all. And she confessed it, you know. That would mean she's not really a Hindu at all, not really part of any tradition at all. So this is the true story of Ananda and my mom's now coming out. I'm giving it out right now. I asked her to help me actually just recently. I said, you know, what do you want me to do? I said, you know, I don't know what to do. I've got all these pictures. I've got more pictures. I found some new pictures yesterday. I'm like a bloodhound for her pictures. Yeah, I can find them. I found some new ones. Wow, never seen them. Really good ones. Holy cow. I said, I don't know what to do with your pictures. You know, I got more pictures of you than anyone in the world, most likely. Yeah, most likely. And I don't know what to do with them. I got no idea. So help! This is really a problem for me. Should I just get rid of them all? I said, no, I won't do that. I'm not gonna do that. You know, I've flushed a lot of stuff down before in my life. I regretted it. So I'm not gonna do that. There's got to be a better way. We talk about ETs helping us divert, you know, avoid nuclear war and so on. There's no doubt that they played some role. There may have been multiple nuclear war possibilities on this planet, actually, that we've been able to divert and postpone. But in my mind, there's no question that Ananda Maima has helped us avoid a nuclear catastrophe and global war. Postpone it, at least, to push it down the road. And everybody, they tried to put her in a tradition. She'll always say, "Leave me out of this. Leave me out of it. Just take me for take me as you see me, but don't try to build anything up around me. Leave me out of it." So she came here for a very specific purpose. Was sent here by God. Was sent here by the divine, which is the Omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. And that Omniverse sent her this appearance into this world to avert catastrophe here. And she succeeded at that. She succeeded at it. Very humbling, to recognize the trouble that we're in, that God had to do that. The Omniverse of perfection, loving perfection, had to realize it had to take, this measure to help us out, because we're trying to throw ourselves into real chaos. Of course, absurdity believes that chaos is its secret agent is chaos, and is trying to throw us into chaos here, so it can then claim that a figurehead, a religious figurehead in a religion that is based on absurdity, is a way to reconstitute ourselves out of this chaos. And so this is a very, very dangerous, delaying sort of situation. And for the sake of the devotees in this world, the divine sent this great secret agent, double agent, into the world to soften up the nationalism and the attitude, egoic attitudes, so that us devotees of truth, of option A, which is just truth is true, nothing else is true, would have some more time to work on our path. And, and living through all this, I can tell you, the threat of nuclear war was intense. Has been intense quite a few times, actually. We talk about the Cuban Missile Crisis, how that was averted, is a miracle that was averted. But there have been numerous crises where nuclear war has almost broken out. And there have been various trends that, if it had not been altered, would have certainly led to nuclear war. And so, it's only the grace of God that softened these trends up, that postponed it. The potential is still very much there in this world. There are some who feel that it is going to happen soon. I don't know. I'm not going to say one way or the other, because the grace of God can work miracles in this regard. What we can all do collectively, we can just say, okay, we'll maybe entertain this option of an all-out nuclear war in some future life. Okay? Future life, but we'll reassemble and see if we need to work on entertain this. That's an option. That's an option that we can exercise. So we're going to put this as an option we can exercise in the distant future. But for right now, we're going to decide not to do that. We're going to decide to just abide in bliss right now. We can do this. We could do this. This is the how I see miracles working. I'm very clear about this. We can send all illness, all suffering. This is the greatness of Christianity, actually. Christianity has some tremendous greatness to it that isn't properly recognized. And this is the idea of putting all our sins on Jesus. Since Jesus was raised from the dead, this is showing us we can have a future life, right? So by putting all our sins, suffering and all that stuff, put all our junk on Jesus, and then Jesus can act for us, make a decision for us to exercise, have an option for some distant future life where we can entertain all this junk at that point. But for right now, we're going to be free of all that junk. Okay, this is the great technique of Christianity. I find it is it's the top technique, or let's say it's co-centric top technique. give all your sins to Jesus. This is a very profound technique, and it works because Christians realize that Jesus rose from the dead, showing us that there is life, that not only life after death in the afterlife, but you can literally resurrect from the dead and have another life. Okay? So it means we too can have another life. So we can put all our junk into this other life, but be free of it right now. Be free of it right now. Be living in the grace of God, the grace of Christ, right now. St. Paul said, all my junk has died, and I'm living in Christ now. You see, we can do that. So Christianity has been working on this particular option, which is a super advanced option, actually. Awesomely advanced option of right now, give all your junk to Jesus. And we trust him that he'll put it as an option for a future life for us. He won't get rid of it. He'll say, what? Because he knows that we're perfectly free to exercise any option we want to. I mean, we can literally, our creativity is this, like this. We can literally imagine multiple worlds, infinite worlds if we want, all with different appearance of agedness to them. The world will appear fresh sprung out of our creativity of mind with evidence of, like, it's like this world's a billion years old with all the wearing down of river gorges and fossils of dinosaur bones, and the entire historical record will all be present. But we can imagine this all this very instant, and such a world will arise for us. And in fact, multiple worlds. In fact, there's no end to the worlds we can imagine with all sorts of evidence of aging present instantly right now. I've done this to a certain extent. I've been able to imagine landscapes, different worlds, all with different appearances, but instantaneously arising. So we can have a world instantaneously arise that will look 4 billion years old. If you looked at all the evidence, say, oh, this has been here for 4 billion years. And yet, it's all being imagined in this instant. And then we can stop imagining at this very instant. Literally, this is easy for us, actually. This is just natural, normal functioning for us. So we can certainly, this is our freedom, we can certainly imagine a future life, in some world, where we can entertain all this junk of absurdity. We can entertain all this absurdity if we want to. So Jesus knows this. Jesus is not going to take this away from us. He's going to say, great, I'll set aside a life for you at some other future time if you want. And that'll be there for you if you want to entertain that stuff. No problem. So this is like a super spiritual technique. And I know not many know it, but Christians intuitively know this. They've been intuitively kind of working on this, actually. So I'm introducing this here in a very clear explanation of how to do it. So if we want a nuclear war, fine. No problem. Jesus doesn't judge it. We don't judge. Jesus does judge not. Whatever we want to experience is equally wonderful. It's all, we're free to do so. But we can also decide not to do it right now. And we can say, I can set aside some other, as long as we want to keep the notion of absurd notion of time, then let's use that in the right way and say, okay, I'll be absurd later. Okay, but not right now. Not right now. We can do that. How are we doing on this video? Okay, it's going great. We can do that. We can do this. So this is the great empowerment that Jesus has given us. The great empowerment. This is the great technique. Everything, all absurdity, transfer to a future life. Just no absurdity right now whatsoever, but the option to entertain absurdity in a future life, it's very much there, like a cloud far in the distance. Imagine a cloud. There's a beautiful clear sky, and way in the distance, there's this little cloud. And you say, okay, it's fine. I'll keep that little cloud for now. Jesus calls us the intermediate step. You can keep that little cloud. Everything else is crystal clear, and dwelling in this crystal clarity. But if I want to exercise the option to go visit that little cloud, I can do so. Now, I may decide I don't want to. That's also, we're free. God doesn't say we have to experience anything specifically. So we can say, well, I don't feel like experiencing that little cloud right now. Fine, I'm free. But potentially, I always can. I can always entertain absurdity again if I want to. So this is the super technique of Jesus Christ. If you're sick, just put it on down the road. Say, well, maybe right now I'm going to be immaculately well, but maybe in that little cloud far in the distance, I might entertain that little cloud of all sickness, little cloud of strife and war and sickness and death and all that. In a future life, maybe I'll go visit that cloud, entertain that little play, that little theater of the absurd. Yeah, that little cloud represents the theater of the absurd. At some point, I may visit the theater of the absurd, you know? Yeah, I might, if I feel like it, and I might not. I'm free to go either way on this. I don't know when the video will end. It just keeps on trucking, doesn't it?
Yeah.
This is really something.
I hope it's recording. Let me see. Is it recording? Is it?
I don't know. Yeah, it seems to still be recording.
Okay.
Theater of the absurd. That's all this world really. That's the option that we're entertaining. But we don't have to see it that way, actually. We can see it option A, which is just truth is true. Nothing else is true. And then we realize there's only this omniverse of perfection, loving perfection, just loving perfection. Perfection loves perfection. It loves being perfect. Perfection loves being perfect. Perfection loves being perfect, that is for sure. Perfection loves being perfect. So we can realize that right here, right now, actually. We can realize that right here, right now. We can accept this. We can accept this option if we want, right now. Now, most will need to go to a reduced intensity zone to work on this. But they can accept that they're going to work towards this option A. They're going from option B to option A. Or even from option C to option A. But usually, that doesn't happen so often. Right? Not so often. So, we'll say from option B to option A. Option B or C to option A. But to go to reduced intensity zone to work on that. I may need to do that myself. I'm aware it's possible, but I don't know if I'll do it or not. I've glimpsed it. I don't know if I will abide in it or not here in this world, or may need to go to a reduced intensity zone. Possible. Either way, it's fine. Just as long as it gets done quickly. What's today?
I think it's the 28th.
Yeah, 28th. Leap year. One more day in February. Leap year. I ordered some stuff from Amazon. Three different things, different times. And I'm waiting for it. It's not showing up. Finally, I see this email. I open it up. It says, well, we decided to combine all your orders into one shipment. So it's all arriving on this one package on the same day. I said, oh. Well, I mean, there's something I wanted. I ordered first. I wanted to get here. It should be here by now. You know, got delayed. it's like, let's put all trends together in one package, so it's all going to arrive at the same time. This is what's going to happen in July of this year. All these trends, absurdist trends, are going to converge in one package somehow, and then, you know. Then we're going to, everybody's going to be screaming for a figurehead, you know, help, 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 figurehead, need a figurehead, we need a bureaucracy, we need someone to crack the whip and get us, you know, everything in, back into order, because this is, things are falling apart too much. And of course the figurehead in waiting, pretty good idea who that is, will say, gee, I don't really want to do this. I mean, that, you know, I don't have any desire at all to be so powerful, actually. But if everybody insists upon it, you know, I will have to acquiesce. I have to serve, you know. If called, I will serve. You know, of course, they'll play it that way.
What do you expect?
They've set it all up, so they're here waiting, ready to take on that role and lusting after it like crazy.
But they will, then they'll play the role. Oh, no. I've had my power, I've had my fun, I don't have any interest whatsoever in being, you know, being this figurehead and the world leader, and, you know, and come on.
Sure, I could do it. I'd be absolutely fabulous at it. You know, I'd be, obviously, I'm the one who could do it, but I don't really want to. I don't want to have any that much power. Come on. I'm a humble person. No. Help. You got to do it. You got to do it. No. Oh, yeah, please. We'll, you know, no, I don't really. He says, no, we'll do it. Whatever you say, whatever you tell us to do, we'll do it. Trust us. You know, no trouble. We won't cause any trouble for you. Well, you know, I don't know. Really? I mean, well, I can see you really need help. I'm the only one that can help you. So if I don't help you, you're all going to suffer so terrible. So, okay, I'll do it. But, yeah, oh, I don't really want to. But I humbly accept your offer, and I will be the new world dictator. And you know, I know I'm going to do it just because I want to be so great at it. That's why I'm going to do it. That's all set up. It's all set up. But first, you know, comes the panic, you know, first comes the panic. So people are come desperate, panically desperate for a figurehead, for an idol they can serve, that they can use to coalesce their belief system around. When belief systems are shattered, then people are desperate to coalesce around a figurehead, belief system. They become desperate for it. Why is the mail truck going by here? It's Sunday. That's very odd, indeed. Something very unusual just happened there. A U.S. Postal Service truck, the one that normally delivers mail from Monday through Saturday, just drove along here. Like I said, it's Sunday. You never see a mail truck driving around through us, do you? I just did. So maybe we're going to see something we've never seen before. Constellation, you know, convergence of many different trends is just going to wham. People will be desperate for a figurehead, coalesce a belief system around, because their belief systems will be suddenly like falling apart. And they just do it again. The mail truck came again. Wow. Maybe UPS is hiring them or something on Sunday. I don't know. Anyway, so we're just about done with this video, probably. Well, let's head it up into high country right now. Now, the question is, will my belief system fall apart? I say, possibly. Because we don't know to what extent it's still resting upon the stability of this world, right? So I cannot sit here and say that my belief system is completely stable. No. No way. No way would I assume that. So I'm saying, help, get me to someplace better, because I don't want to fail. I want to be assured that I don't fail. And there's no way I can feel assured in this situation, in this world. There's no way at this point. Cannot assess that properly. It's not possible. From my standpoint, I don't know how much attraction I still have to the world and attachment and all this kind of stuff. It's not possible to give a accurate assessment. So, from my standpoint, play it safe. Gotta play it safe at this time. Have to play it safe. There's no way I can just say, oh yeah, I'll be fine, and nothing, this stuff shouldn't bother me. I can't say that. I don't know how intense the situation is going to be, what my remaining attachments are, none of that. But I've been told it's going to be so terrible. and my remaining attachments are such that taking refuge is essential. So, you know, that's just a, it seems like a no-brainer to be play it safe. Why not play it safe rather than better safe than sorry is the way to play it. This is just wisdom. It's better, there are certain situations it's better to play to be safe than sorry, meaning discretion is it sometimes the best part of valor. And I feel, I just feel we're in a time that this is in play. This trumps any other situation. Is discretion is the better part of valor? Better play it safe than sorry. That's it. This is how I feel. And I really can't entertain complaints because I just feel overall, this is how I assess, this is my assessment, and I've put a great deal of effort into my assessment, and it's time to make a final assessment. I cannot get into any more explanations about assessment. At some point, assessment, you have to make a judgment. You cannot have the trial go on forever. So, you know, so I'm saying there's no more time for the trial. I've got to end this assessment and say which way, you know, how am I going to play it? Better safe than sorry. Discretion is a better part of valor right now. This is my advice. Final advice. And they say, well, that's not acting like a figurehead that we want you to be. You know, we want the strong male figurehead that we can use, the yoga girls can use to help ease into their goddess worshiping, and then have them on the side do any miracles that's required to make it all look good. I said, we can't have you do that well. That, you know, I'm not suitable for what you want then. And they'll spit on you and say, what a coward, you know, whatever. Well, again, better safe than sorry. Discretion is the better part of valor. That's something that Napoleon hadn't figured out. The generals did figure it out. They were ultimately, you know, way more successful than the ones who hadn't figured that out. Like the great Roman general Fabius, you know. I believe Fabius, who defeated Hannibal. He continually exercised discretion, 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 feeling that he could ultimately wear Hannibal down, his supply lines down, the weather down, everything, and just let him keep winning victories, but keep postponing the ultimate victory. And ultimately, it worked. And the Romans were upset with Fabius. So why don't you go defeat Hannibal? Come on. He said, no, 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 no. He said, what's wrong with you? Aren't you a good general? He said, yeah, I'm just using these tactics. I'm employing wise tactics here. Discretion is the best part of valor here. A direct confrontation, we'd be very much likely lose. We'd likely lose. So there are those who are trying to pressure this confrontation, and Fabius said no. This is where we get the term Fabian socialism, which the socialism avoids a direct encounter with capitalism, but keeps gradually weakening, weakening, weakening it. Capitalism being the expression of ambition here to make this world of the option B of both truth and good absurdity. We can make a world that we're content with that. That's the ambition of capitalism. Whereas socialism is the ambition of option C, which is let's just have all absurdity and claim all absurdity is equally good, and let's coexist with all types of absurdity. No factionalism among absurdity, that's socialism. I've been warned. I'm just feeling right now something is telling me, you know, I'm not going to say what the left is going to do, what they're going to do. I'm not going to say that, okay? So don't keep, you know, don't pester me. Don't even pester me to say, well, you know, what are they going to do? What are the trends? How are they going to spring their trap and all this kind of stuff? We're working on it at a higher level here to choose option A, okay, to get on that bridge. That's our goal here. However, whatever form absurdity takes, it's still absurd, okay? Let's not get caught up in the trap of good and bad absurdity. This is the trap that's made us vulnerable to the absurdists. We have to stay away from that. That's why I'm boycotting the news. I'm not paying attention to any of this, what's going on. It doesn't really matter. Whatever they do is what they do. It's designed, again, to create confusion and chaos so that we grab a hold of this figurehead and worship it. And bring in the new world order. This is what it's designed to do. So however they decide to trigger that is they have their plans, whatever it is. So, you know, they will do what they want to do. We'll do what we want to do in terms of sidestepping it. And again, we're not condemning them at all. We'll say we might even entertain this in some future life, okay? It's just not right now. Just why we choose not to. That's why we're free to choose. It's just we're not our curiosity. It doesn't really pique our curiosity at this point. We're curious, more curious about experiencing the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. That's where our curiosity is at right now. That's all. But we're not condemning. We're not judge not lest ye be judged. We're not judging at all. We're just saying, not now. Not interested in this right now. We're more interested in focusing on our option A, and how to make that happen. I can, I will, I already have. I can see the omniverse of perfect love of perfection, loving perfection. I will see the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. I'm already seeing the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. I am already seeing the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. I'm already experiencing this. I can experience this. I will experience this. I'm already experiencing this. I can experience the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. I will experience the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. I am experiencing the omniverse of perfection, loving perfection. So every day is a new level of intensity. This is an even higher level of intensity. Yesterday was very intense. It was a nature day. It was an outing experiencing the intensity of the ocean. It was really quite astonishing. Beautiful. It was extraordinary. And today, and plus that great breakthrough of glimpsing the omni.